This hangout is live. Hey everybody, it's Jeff Lafferty and also Mike Fleming Jr.
Hey everyone, how's it going?
Yeah, doing a little live streaming. I see Simon's in the chat. How's it going, man? Kill the audio. Cool. Ready to go. Somebody else is in the chat too. Train, Brandon Franks. Hey guys. Gonna do some drawing. You guys should get out your own sketch pads and do some drawing with us. We're gonna go for a couple hours. Get some work done.
Get them donuts going, right?
Get the donuts made.
How did that go?
Time to make the donuts or something, that thing.
Oh, that's right.
You're talking about most famous donut commercial of all time.
I think it was a bit before my time.
I'm sure you missed it before your time. There was like this little pudgy guy that kind of looked like Mario from, you know, Donkey Kong.
Okay.
He'd wake up half asleep and walk like a zombie and go, time to make the donuts, time to make the donuts. It was a Dunkin' Donuts commercial, I'm pretty sure.
That sounds pretty cool.
Yeah, it was a good one. Should have actually switched the color of my airbrush because I got to blow it and it's going to be a little bit loud. But so what kind of clay you using, Mike? I just noticed you opened up some clay.
I'm using just regular, just right out of the box, Super Sculpey right now. I usually make my own mix, which is what this is. This is like the gray. It's like a mix between regular and firm, and then a little bit extra things that I add in. And that's what I did Yoda here in. I actually finished Yoda, and I just baked him, and I tried smoothing him with a different type of lighter fluid, and actually cracked his chest a little bit, which I'm glad. Oh, wow. I just tested it there. Because it would have been bad if it would have done it everywhere. So later I'll dig this out and repair it. But yeah, he's finished and baked.
Cool.
I put some highlights in his eyes and I made his bottom lip a little longer because it looked a little funny. Or his top lip, I mean.
Yeah.
But he came out pretty cool, I think.
He looks neat. I think he looks great.
Yeah, thanks, man. And then I'm going to have, like, once I paint some of them, I'm going to have, like, some of this, you know, that fur that he has or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, fluff. I'll figure out how to get this fluff to work.
That's neat.
But, yeah, he was fun little guy to sculpt. Didn't take me too long either.
Yeah. Can't wait to see it, like, when you pull some molds or pull some casts, I guess.
Yeah.
And see what those guys look like. How much do you think you'll be selling those for?
Probably like $30, probably. Something really cheap.
Yeah. That'll be cool. Somebody says, is this for claymation the one you do now? I think he's getting it. Because I do like the stop motion. I imagine he's talking about me for like the Wolf's Heart, and then like I'm just streaming with a guy Mike Fleming, and he's a sculptor and he does his own sculpture for his own stuff, and that's what Mike's doing right now. But he also is an animator too, so
yeah, I think that's how we first met, was just through stop motion.
I remember. Were you emailing me
many
minutes ago? Yeah, you like, and it was stop motion. It was like, I don't know where I was posting, but it was sort of like, I think maybe Mark's board, that animateclay.com.
It was that stop motion magic one that he had for a while.
Oh, right, yeah. And And then I remember, like, you emailed me, and then you, like, it was, like, really quick. I mean, I was just busy with, you know, like, back then I was doing sketch cards and didn't get to your email, like, right away. And then you emailed me back, like, and I always remember this, and you were, like, really kind of, like, pissy with me. Like, you know, like, you know, like, you'd appreciate a response or something like that.
I don't know.
Jesus Christ. Who is this guy?
That don't sound like me. Like, I don't know.
Demanding me to email him.
I think you're thinking of someone else there, buddy.
So I immediately wrote you and told you, like, to fuck off, and then we were, like, friends forever after that.
You told me you're a painter, and I was like, oh, geez, now we got to be pals.
Now we gotta, and we all lived in Colorado, which was another, you know, coincidence or whatever you call it. Yeah, that was a while ago, because I mean, it was, you know, it was definitely before Tristan. I mean, I started the animation thing before Tristan, and he kind of showed up maybe a year into it, I guess.
Yeah.
And then
Tristan definitely was not around.
Yeah, he's like 6 years old now, so pretty cool.
He's flying by.
And I remember I took a look at your animation, and you had, like, you had some of that Denver Broncos cartoon guy stuff, or no, it was like the Moose or something. There was some cartoon guy that was doing, like, the.
Oh, it was the Tundra, the Tundra
right.
Thing.
And then you had one animation from that too, like And I think it was like the clay on glass, wasn't it? Where the guy was talking, it was really cool, but it was like really short.
Yeah, it was clay on glass, and it was a clip from They Live. It's just what I did as a test. And the guy really liked it and everything, so.
That's cool.
And I think it never ended up. I was never allowed to show it.
Yeah.
I think I just showed it to you. Get your
right
opinion or whatever.
I remember. I mean, didn't you have like a frog talking or something also?
Yeah.
Or is that just a sculpture I'm thinking of?
It was a frog, and he was talking. He was doing a line from Tombstone, Val Kilmer's line. What the hell was that line? Geez, I've listened to it a million times. What was that line?
Oh, from like Val Kilmer and Doc Holliday and Tombstone?
Oh yeah, it was if I thought you weren't my friend, I don't think I could bear it. Yeah, that's what it was.
Oh, okay. that was pretty good. I mean, I think he was probably the best part of that one. That wider movie as Val Kilmer. He was awesome as Doc Holliday in that.
Yeah, I actually won that contest that he was a part of.
Oh, really?
So yeah, that was cool.
That's neat. I like that other one though. That was the Kevin Costner, Doc Holliday, and Wyatt Earp movie. That was a good one also. I like both of them. They're different in their own ways.
They're both Wyatt Earp?
That one? Yeah, I mean, Kevin, I think they even came out the same year. It was like the one with Kurt Russell and what's his name? Val Kilmer, and then they did one with Kevin Costner, and I think Dennis Quaid was actually Val Kilmer in that one.
Or, I mean, was actually
Doc Holliday. It's really good, actually. It's more of like the one's almost more of like an action flick, like the Kurt Russell one, and then the other one's kind of more like a drama type. Well, I don't know. I mean, they're both action, but one's like more of like an epic kind of movie, I think, like the Costner one. So
yeah.
But I really like.
I'll have to look that up.
Yeah, you probably really enjoy it, actually. If you like westerns, because I think that's one of my favorite westerns.
Even over Tombstone?
I kind of like it better. I don't know why. I just always have. There's like a gunfight in the end, like when you know, I don't remember exactly. It's like they either get ambushed or whatever. I don't know. Kevin Costner was just in the middle of it, getting shot at and stuff. And it's really cool.
Yeah, I'm definitely gonna have to look that up. There's always a cool gunfight for sure.
Right.
That was one of the cool things about The Lone Ranger. I don't know if you've seen that remake, but
yeah, I saw that.
There's this really cool cowboy scene with, like, at the beginning. That's just really cool.
Yeah. I kind of liked how they did the CG horse. Even though I think a lot of that movie was kind of corny, it was like, I liked how they did the CG horse where he's like riding on a train and shit and jumping underneath the tunnel and everything. It was pretty neat.
Yeah. Did you like the guy who was Lone Ranger?
Yeah, I mean, I guess. I don't know.
Everyone said they don't like, oh, not everyone. I don't know. A lot of people that I talked to said they don't like him.
Yeah, it was all way more funny than I thought it was going to be. You know what I mean? It was almost more like more towards the humor. So,
yeah, I think they're doing kind of like trying to make it a little bit like Pirates, like humor wise.
Yeah, it definitely had that feel for sure.
I think it was actually the same director even.
Oh, was it?
And then, of course, you got Johnny Depp in there.
Yeah. Did you ever see that other one with Russell Crowe, that 310 to Yuma or whatever? That was a pretty good Western, like a new one.
Yeah, that was good. I saw that at the movie house, actually. That was a good one.
Yeah, I wish they'd make more Westerns, really. I mean,
they just, wasn't there one that just came out recently? It was real good. Man, who is that guy that's like, he's like old and he's like wheezy. I love that guy, Jeff Bridges.
Oh, he's wheezy?
Yeah, he's like always like wheezing.
Yeah, I like Jeff Bridges. Awesome.
Yeah, it was like True Grit. He was in that. Oh. That was a good Western.
Man, I have like never seen that yet, and I don't know why. I just keep forgetting to like try to download it or something. But yeah, that's such a good movie. Like, I love the John Wayne version. Like the book. If you've ever read the book is awesome. I mean, it's like, it's so good. You know. It's like based on this book, True Grit, and
I've never seen the original or the book.
Oh man,
I just saw the remake or whatever.
Yeah, the original John Wayne one is like awesome.
My mom actually got it for me, but I haven't watched it yet.
It's really good.
I'll have to watch that tomorrow.
I mean, I'm like a John Wayne fan though. I like a lot of his movies.
I don't think I've ever seen a John Wayne movie, actually.
Oh, my God. How can you not? And you're like a fan of Westerns. I mean, like, what are you a fan of?
I'm a huge fan of Westerns. Just like
80%.
Ones in the color, you know? Ones that are...
ones in the color. I almost want to make you like a list of like the great John Wayne Westerns. Give you like a
I've seen some of the old Western TV shows, like what's that one called?
Gunsmoke.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Gunsmoke.
You know, Gunsmoke, like early on, was actually pretty good. Like if you catch like some of the old ones that are like in black and white before like they had like Festus on there, those are actually pretty good. But I don't know, that show just went on for so long. It felt like it turned into like kind of like Little House on the Prairie, you know. It just seemed like there's just never any action in it.
Little House on the Prairie is a great show.
Yeah, but not for a Western. It's like, when I want a Western, I don't want to watch Little House on the Prairie.
Is that considered Western? I thought that was like more like coming out of that whole the end of the cowboys.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if it. What you? I mean, it was in the West. Obviously, they were settlers, but
like Zorro, and wasn't Zorro kind of Western, or is that? Yeah, I'm thinking of Lone Ranger.
Like, well, Zorro and Lone Ranger is sort of like the same era. They were on around the same time.
Those are both like considered westerns, right?
Oh, hell yeah. I mean, that's used to be like what was on in the morning when I was a kid. I'd even like wake up early to watch Lone Ranger. And then Zorro wasn't on as consistently, but I would catch that every now and then, and I loved it.
That's the one with Zorro. He didn't have a sidekick, what? Right? Zorro?
No, he did, actually. He's not like Tonto where you really remember him, though. He's like this guy with a sombrero. Can't remember what they even called him in the show. He wasn't super memorable.
He wasn't like Kato.
Kato, yeah. Well, Kato was memorable. Somebody in the chat says, do you think mixing Crayola crayons or pencils and other brands is good or bad depending on on tricks and stuff? And I think, yeah, it's totally fine. I mean, I don't know about Crayola. I use like Prismacolor. I use Faber-Castell, like the Derwent color pencils. And, you know, I've even used some oil with them and, you know, they hold up fine. So I'm not real super familiar with the Crayola brand, but, you know, my son's got a lot of color pencils around here and there for different sets. Some of them could be like Crayola, and I think it's, you know, I think it's just fine. I think whatever makes a mark and you can make work, you know, is good. So I saw that question from a couple days ago or yesterday or something, so I wanted to make sure I answered it. Sorry, Mike, what were you saying?
I don't remember.
You're talking about what? You're talking about Zorro's sidekick, actually.
Oh. Yeah, I don't even know he had a sidekick. I know he had... I knew that Zorro had... I thought Zorro was just his own lone gun, like, type deal.
Well, yeah.
Because I had the model kit of him and Lone Ranger and then Tonto.
Yeah. In the TV show, like in the whenever that was, the 50s or whatever, that there was sort of like the sidekick character. Like in most of the movies, though, there's not, you know. So yeah, it wasn't really like, you know, like a Batman and Robin or, you know, like you said, Lone Ranger and Tonto kind of situation. But like in the TV show, there was definitely like this goofy comedy relief kind of character that hung around him. So. I loved all those shows when I was a kid. I was just addicted to them. They were like better than, you know, the new stuff that was on TV, I think, at the time.
Was it better than movies back then, or did you still prefer going to the movie house and seeing like some sort of monster movie or something?
No, to me, like the movies were always the best, you know, for sure. I think like nowadays, like some of the TV's better than movies, like with like, you know, Walking Dead and stuff.
They say that's why a lot of movies are like bombing right now.
Hmm.
TV options are so good. People would just rather stay home. And
I could see that.
I was watching this, you know, cause I went and saw King Arthur probably a week or so ago.
Was that any good?
I thought it was really, really good. I thought it was awesome. And I know you'd love that movie.
Yeah.
But for some reason, like, it didn't do very well. And there was, like, this video online, and they were, like, speculating as to why it bombed when it cost so much to make. And one of the reasons was TV is just doing way better right now than, you know. And also, it didn't get, like, great reviews. And also it cost a lot of money to make, and they didn't really promote it very well. And they don't think that the guy who plays King Arthur, which is Jax and from Sins of Anarchy, they don't think he can pull a whole movie by himself, like a starring role. He did Pacific Rim, and that made a lot of money, didn't it?
I think so. I don't know. I don't really pay attention to, you know what I mean? It's like I kind of either just like it or I don't like it. I don't really pay attention to what everybody's saying. But I watched some of the episodes of Anarchy, and I kind of always meant to go back and watch more of them. I liked him in that, so.
Did you ever see Pacific Rim?
No, I've never seen that one yet.
Sorry, I think that
one. Did you like that one?
Yeah, I thought it was cool. Like monsters versus big robots.
Yeah.
It was like Guillermo del Toro or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. No, actually, it looked pretty cool. Man, it's like, I gotta go hunt down my knife. So sorry, I gotta get up for a minute. Because I can't draw without sharpening my pencils, unfortunately. I'm gonna be back in a minute. I'm sorry, dude. That's cool.
How's everybody doing tonight? Thanks for hanging out with us. I'm not super great about keeping an eye on the chat, but I'll try and keep an eye on there over here. It's really cool you guys are joining us.
Quiet. Are you sitting here in silence the whole time?
not the whole time.
Chat's empty. What happened?
It was a good time for everyone to go get a drink or whatever.
Right. Community tea break. Everybody went all at the same time. So Abe's in the chat. Hey, Abe.
I was just telling them that I'm not super great about looking over at the chat.
Yeah.
And as soon as you see that, I went over there and started looking at it. And it's next up.
That's cool. Do you have it open or do you not?
I do, but I didn't have it on that window. So then I found it and opened it. And
yeah. Well, somebody asked what inspires you to draw. I don't know.
What inspires you to draw, Jeff?
I don't know.
Deadlines?
I don't really have an answer. Money, yeah. I wish money did inspire me to draw. It'd be a hell of a lot easier. I don't know. I'm not sure, dude. I wish I had like some grand answer. Just always wanted to be creative, I guess. I want to make my own Star Wars or something like that from a kid and then just never let go of the dream, I guess. What about you, Mike?
I don't know. I don't really draw.
Well, what makes you want to sculpt? Why would you? Why in the world would you want to be a sculptor, for Christ's sake? That's just so hard.
It's actually just a lot of fun, I think. Mm. And then, like, you know, kind of a similar thing. I just always wanted to make stop motion movies and animations and stuff, and I just kind of want, you know, I just always wanted my sculptures to be good, like, you know, the ones that I would animate, and then I always had a love for model kits and stuff like that, so I would always build the model kits, but I would never paint them because I never liked that part of it, and I was never any good at it. So I just have tons of like model kits that I built, but none of them were ever painted. And then I was like, well, it'd be cool if I could make my own model kits.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how that all happened.
That makes sense. Makes sense. I was definitely like, I didn't do as many model kits, but I was like, you know, like a kid who was always like making stuff, you know what I mean? I was always making swords or, you know, like I made a castle for all my like He-Man guys, stuff like that.
Yeah.
So.
I remember I used to like take, you know, action figures and stuff and put big blobs of clay on their feet.
Oh, that's so funny.
And like try to animate those and just spend hours and hours and hours. And I didn't even have an animation camera.
Oh, that's cool. I thought when you were going to say like the big blobs of clay that you were like making like armor and stuff for them. Cause my son actually does that with his Play-Doh. He sticks Play-Doh on his little people and tries to make like, you know, whatever he's trying to do. Iron Man suits or something. It's kind of neat.
That's awesome. I was just trying to get him to stand up so I could get him to walk.
Yeah, that makes sense. I know. Wouldn't it have been cool, dude? Like, you know, if you were born like nowadays with all the Lego animation and all that. I mean,
oh, yeah.
I totally like doing like toy animations.
Like webcams and like all that whole, like that. No, that stuff was around when I was growing up. Or at least I didn't have access to it.
I just don't think it was even in existence, actually. You had to be like a government official to have a webcam. Work for NORAD or something.
But yeah, I mean, it. Well, the camera we had, it was just like a, you know, video camera.
Yeah.
And just like would take, you know, I'd hit start and stop on the record button. And it would take like, you know, 150 frames.
Right. Was it taped on, did it go onto like a videotape or something? Or like a video cassette tape?
Yeah, like one of those little ones that you'd like take out and then put into a bigger one. That's the one my parents had.
Right. I kind of remember when those started coming out. I was like already, you know, sort of grown up by then. I had I don't know if it was like a Super 8 or what, but it, you know, it filmed like that kind of film. It was like a little roll of film that you took somewhere, got developed, brought back, you stuck it on a projector and projected it.
Oh wow, really?
It didn't have any sound, and it was like a little movie camera that had like a little flip down handle, and you just push the button. And I actually do remember trying to animate some of like my toys just by doing that, like click the button like super fast and then move it, click it. And it was just, you know, looked like an earthquake.
Yeah, it was.
What's going on?
I used to like try to animate my model kits too. I had these dinosaurs. Like Triceratops and T-Rex and stuff that were from Jurassic Park.
Cool.
And I tried to like animate those, but you know, they didn't move, so I just like slid them around. And then I had these little clay puppets that I'd make out of like trash, you know, those twist ties that come with trash bags, because I didn't have like armature wire.
Yeah. That's good thinking right there. Those things are tough.
I didn't have like YouTube tutorials or anything, so I was just trying to like patch together anything I think I could get to work.
That's what inspired me, honestly, to get back in animation later in life, was just YouTube and just seeing what people were doing and being like, oh my God, you know, people are like telling you how to do it right here. Look at this. This is how you put the camera up. This is how you get the live feed. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just such an eye opener. I was like, oh, what the heck? It's all right here.
Yeah. I used to like watch animations and stuff and just be completely fascinated by, like, you know, because I had no idea how they were doing it. I was like, how are they even doing this kind of stuff?
Yeah.
And then there was a on Reading Rainbow one day, there was this this episode where there were these animators and they're animating these pigs splashing around in mud.
Yeah.
And they were kind of showing the process, and I remember thinking that's just, you know, beyond cool.
Yeah.
And actually, they put those up on Netflix or something recently, and I found that episode.
That's cool.
I watched it again. I was like, wow, that's cool. Because I remember the pigs in the mud vividly.
Yeah.
Like being a little kid or whatever.
Yeah. That's neat. I remember seeing like when I was a kid, they had this show on that was called like, it's like the World of Hollywood or something, or the World of Movie Making or something like that. And each week they have like a, it would just kind of show a different aspect of like making movies and stuff, you know?
Uh-huh.
So like one week could be about stuntmen, and one week, and they had one about, I don't know if it was all about Harry, but it had Harryhausen in it. It had Star Wars, which Star Wars had just come out like recently or something. So it was showing like the blue screen and stuff that they used with Star Wars.
Yeah.
And they showed, you know, I mean, like the Harryhausen stuff was showing like, and they might have showed some of King Kong too, where, you know, whatever footage from that they had. And so that was like, I think the first time I'd ever seen, you know, like this idea of like moving stuff frame by frame or whatever. But it just was like, you know, you just, as a kid, to me, it just seemed so out of my reach, you know, to like actually film stuff. I don't think I even had that camera at the time.
Yeah.
But the Star Wars stuff definitely, you know, like as soon as like I started getting a load of, you know, I just like every kid in the world, but, you know, there was just like Starlog, the magazine was coming out and stuff, and they'd have articles about, you know, stuff like that. And then, you know, like the Fangoria magazine was like the makeup art and stuff.
Yeah. And I don't,
and then I had this book too. What?
Well, I was just going to say, I don't, you know, I never seen any of that stuff growing up, but I know about it now.
Yeah.
But I never like, you know, went to a comic shop or something and, or wherever you saw those.
Yeah.
And then,
well, those were just on the newsstand, because I didn't even know like comic shops existed at that point, but they'd be like at the 7-Elevens. So I like beg my dad to buy me like Starlog. He'd buy it for me.
That's cool, man.
Yeah.
So like, is that kind of like where you, was that your first introduction to animation or like monsters and stuff like that? Or
I think so. And then I found a book in the library. I remember this. This, I think, inspired a lot of my early stuff like that, because it was this book that was about like the Universal Monsters and also like how they made the movies. So, and I think it was called like Making Monsters or something like that. And they showed you how to make like the Frankenstein. Like each one was like about the movie, and then it would show like a prop from the movie. So like the Frankenstein was like, was the Frankenstein head. And so, like, they wanted you to make it out of, like, I think it was, like, paper bags, and then you tape around it, and you paint it, and, you know, put hair on it. And there was, like, this one, the mummy hand that I did. That was, like, one that worked out pretty good. What you did was you get, like, an old leather glove that kind of has the wrinkles from the fingers, and then you wrap it in, like, Band-Aids, or not Band-Aids, but stretch Band-Aids and stuff, and then you'd put like cornstarch all over it, so it looked all wrinkly and stuff. And I always remember that one because my dad was always like, he just like hated that thing. You know, he's just like, we throw that gross thing away. I love that book, and I made everything, you know, in there at some point.
That's cool. That's a cool, sounds like a great book for kids, actually.
I should try to like hunt it down and see if I can find it for Tristan, because like I do remember just finding that like in the library at school, and that's where I got it from. So, or it might have been in one of those book fours, because it's actually, I never took it back, so it must have been like one of those like, you know, book fairs where you get a book, but they're all like in the library. I don't know if they still do that.
I remember that actually. Something I got a Garfield book that way somehow.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, you get one of those, you get them all, right?
Right.
Garfield's so consistent anymore.
Well, Garfield was a neat comic strip, you know, I guess.
Yeah, it's kind of. Yeah, I mean, it's cool, but I mean, like, you know.
Yeah.
Has it been like 30 years now or something?
Right. Still looks exactly the same. I wonder if that same guy actually draws it, or if it's like Ghost Artist now, or what.
It's like the same, you know, same things all the time. Still in lasagna, kicking the dog off the table.
Yeah. Hey, Pete actually jumped in the chat. Hey, Pete. How's it going, man? Long time no see.
What's up, man? Did you ever used to like make like live action movies with like friends or buddies or anything like that?
I mean, yeah, we tried to do that too with that camera, but like I think like the camera, you know, like it had a like the max was like a 5 minute kind of reel, you know. So I remember running around trying to film stuff and then, you know, like cutting it in between the cuts and all that. But I don't remember doing that too much. And I think a lot of that was just because, like, you know, you had to get the film developed. So, you know what I mean? It's like I had to, you know, once I shot something, then I had to, you know, let my parents, like, take it and develop it. And, you know, they never seemed to want to do it. So.
I could tell why, probably. They're like.
I don't care what you and your friends are doing.
How much is it? $15 a roll? Yeah, we're not.
Right.
That store closed, Jeff.
The thing I remember more doing with my friends, though, was like making the comic books. Like I was like the one of my friends that could draw. So I would like draw, like my mom would always buy me these big pads of newsprint. And I would draw comics of like me and my friends. I've told this a million times, but of me and my friends in the newsprint. And then like all my friends just loved it. You know what I mean? So like, you know, they'd all be characters. And like I did one where we were all secret agents, like a James Bond secret agents and stuff like that. Fighting like Nazis. It was always Nazis. Cause I was all into the Raiders Lost Ark. So the bad guys always had to be Nazis, you know? And I don't know. Like set, that was just fun.
Set around school or what? Were you guys like?
No, we were all like, you know,
all over the world.
In the world. Yeah. And then, you know, but I always remember this though. Like I came to a part where I wanted to kill somebody and it's like, I couldn't kill anybody because nobody wanted to die. You know, like as soon as like I said somebody was going to die, they'd get all mad at me. So I couldn't like actually kill anybody and I had to figure out a way to kill somebody and then bring them back later kind of a thing.
That's funny.
Yeah. But that was just, I remember doing that just for the longest time. Like even like into high school, like when it was uncool and like, you know, I'm supposed to be into girls and stuff. And I was like still drawing comics with all my friends, you know, fighting Nazis. Just total nerd.
What did you do with them? Did you just like make print or copies and then give them all away to classmates or?
No, the only copy machine I had ever saw back then was there was like a copy machine in the library and it cost like a dime or something every time you wanted to make a copy. And then like the only time we ever copied anything is like, I always remember this is like, I drew this cartoon of like one of my teachers and, they, you know, like everybody thought it was funny. And then so like my friends took it to the copy machine in the library, made like a bunch of copies of it. And then they all wrote like all sorts of horrible stuff, like made word balloons with them saying this and this and this. And of course, like it circulated throughout the school. And then, you know, somehow got back to the teacher. And then I had to go to the principal's office and I got in all kinds of trouble for doing it. Yeah. I don't know why I didn't think, yeah, like let's start publishing comics, but it just never occurred to me back then. It was just pretty much something like, you know, when my friends would come over to my house, they jerk over my sketchbook and see like what the next part I drew was, you know.
So they never even had their own copies, pretty much.
No, and I don't that's even cool. have copies of it anymore either.
Oh, that sucks. They're all gone now.
Yeah. Yeah.
I tried drawing comics and stuff of like classmates and stuff like that. Yeah. Like my buddies, like it was usually just around like Nerf because we were into Nerf guns.
Cool.
So we'd like, you know, Planet Nerf, I think is what the name of it was.
Nice.
But it never did anything. And we never even got to a battle. I just like designed the characters of who we all were. And
right.
That was pretty much the end of that.
I had a friend that was kind of into drawing comics too, like earlier, like around sixth grade or maybe fifth grade or something. And he like all these comics, he'd bring like a big stack of comics to school And then I'd bring like my little teeny stack, you know what I mean? And he'd like, sometimes we'd trade some with me or something. And he always wanted, like, I had this one issue of like Ragman, which was like a total like DC bomb that never went anywhere. But there was like, they only put like one issue out. And I don't even know if they put a second one out, but it was like an issue number one. So I was like, yeah, this is important. This is issue number one. You know
what I
mean? Yeah. And he always wanted to trade me for that issue number one. And I was like, no, not that one. Not Ragman. Held on to it. But anyway, that kid would do that. He would like, he had just all these characters, and he would like you said, just design characters all the time, but he never would draw like the stories, you know?
Yeah.
But he had like, you know, this guy's like Magma Man, blah, blah, blah. You know, he's really into like superhero art. So they all looked like real superhero-y and stuff. It's pretty cool.
Yeah. I remember when I was doing art designs, we were all like, you know, I think we were like 10 years old or whatever, but we were like super buff.
Right.
It's like, yeah, we got to be buff.
Yeah, you got to look cool.
I mean, we're shooting Nerf bullets at these monsters. We got to.
That's right. I remember once my mom, you know, like telling me, like I was down at her house and her coming upstairs and she just was like looking at like my stacks of like notebooks of my fantasy worlds with my friends.
Yeah.
and then she tried to have this talk with me where I needed to like, you know, get my head on straight and like, this isn't real life and all this. And then I remember like I went, cause I was just, you know, like when I would visit my mom, I'd just go for weekends and stuff. And then I remember her calling my dad and trying to like talk him into like, you know, making sure that like, I need to, you know, I need to get my head on straight basically. And then my dad like hung up the phone and he's like, your mom told me wanted you to stop, you know, doing all this and blah, blah. He told me everything that she said. And he's like, but I think you should do this. This is, you're pretty good at it. You should keep on going. So he just like totally blew it off. It was pretty awesome. I mean, how stupid is that, though? It's just like your kid's being creative. What do you want me to do? Go out and, like, smoke drugs and, like, be cigarettes behind the 7-Eleven with the loser kids or something, you know?
Yeah, it is. I mean, at least you had, like, real friends and stuff it was all based on. It's not like you're, like, making everyone up or something.
Yeah. Well, we made up all our girlfriends in there, though. We didn't have any girlfriends, so we had to have the made-up girlfriends.
Well, at least she read it all. That's cool, though, I guess. she just wasn't a fan.
Yeah, my mom's always been like, it's funny because she's kind of the one who's a little bit creative. Like my dad, I've never seen him draw or anything. And I remember when I was a kid, my mom would, you know, like I remember one time she told me like it was her birthday. And she's like, you know, yeah, it's my birthday. You could give me a present. And I'm like, what kind of present can I give you? I'm like a kid, you know? So then I thought, I'll draw a picture of King Kong, you know, because I was really into like King Kong. It's like, but I didn't know how to draw a King Kong. I didn't know how to draw a monkey. So I had to like go and ask her, how do you draw like King Kong, you know, like a monkey face? So then I drew it and then she was happy. But she was like, I mean, she was kind of like the more artistic one. So it's kind of funny, but she's always been like, she's always been that. She's always just been so critical of like my work. And I don't know, like when I got to be, you know, I mean, really just most of my life, I just, you know, I just don't really tell her what I'm doing most of the time because she's always like, I don't know.
She doesn't really take it serious.
Well, she not only doesn't take it serious, but she like actively tries to like convince me not to be an artist. You know, I remember when I did comics and, you know, after I was kind of out for a while and I was like telling her one time, she's like, asked me what I'm doing. I'm like, yeah, you know, I'm trying to like, you know, do this comic. And she's like, oh, comics, like, you know, why, you know, that didn't work out. Why don't you, you know, blah, blah, blah. You know, it's like, mom. I'm an artist, for Christ's sake. I'm never going to quit this shit, you know?
Do you remember that damn King Kong I drew you?
That's right. You know how happy that made you? I don't know.
So when you went, like, when you're actually doing it professionally, I mean, that's, you know, it's kind of like...
I know.
Like,
you'd think.
I hate to say it's like checkmate or whatever, but it's like, you know, you're doing it.
Right.
You said you're going to do it and you're doing it.
You would think that that would change your mind, but no. I remember my brother. This happened just a little while ago. Well, no, I guess it's been a few years ago. And he ran into somebody that we knew in high school. And like, you know, like towards the end of high school, everybody kind of knew I could draw, and I drew like a lot of stuff, you know, and was like in the art show and stuff like that. And so like everybody was like, knew me as like the artist, you know?
Yeah.
And, anyway, Keith runs into this guy that we knew from high school, and he worked somewhere around here. And so like, I guess he asked him, he's like, you know, what about Jeff? Like, what's Jeff doing? And he was like saying that, you know, like, I remember, man, he could draw. Did he do anything with that or whatever? And Keith was like, he basically was just like, no, I never really did anything with it. And like at the time, I mean, I don't remember. I think it was even after, I mean, basically I was just like, it's what my living is. You know what I mean? As an artist.
Yeah.
And I was just like, what do you fucking think I do, dude? You know what I mean? Like, what job do you think I'm going to every day, you know? I don't know. I don't get it. But yeah, it's like, that's just kind of the way my family is. My dad's finally sort of accepted it, but like in general, I don't think like my mom even to this day thinks that, you know, this is how I make my living. So I think she just feels like this, you know, I'm probably just being a bum right now. Not going to work.
Yeah.
Jeez, my son, he's just a bum. He's just unemployed.
That's crazy. That's, you know, that's a little sad, actually.
You're
making it, you know, you're doing it. It's not like, you know, sucks there's not really a lot of support, it sounds like.
Well, I don't think they're unsupportive. I mean,
kind of sounds like it.
Well, I mean, you know, like you hear the parents where they're like, you know, they say, you know, don't go to art school, be a doctor, you know, things like that. I mean, my parents definitely never said that kind of stuff to me.
Mm-hmm.
They've always been like, you know, do whatever you want to do. So.
Just not comics.
Yeah. No, I mean, they've never said that like that. So I guess that's why I don't feel like they're not supportive, you know?
Yeah.
But I don't know. It doesn't really matter. Like, I feel like they're older and whatever. So it's just, you know, whatever they want to. I mean, my dad to me is like supportive now. Cause like, you know, he's sort of like seeing the money I can make and stuff. And he's like, ah, he's doing his own business. You know, don't bother going back to painting or something. But yeah, my mom is still, you know,
that's cool. He doesn't want you to go back to painting. Man, that'd be the worst.
Yeah, I don't want to do that.
I mean, either way, also, I mean, because I mean, you own your own business doing that too. But it's like, you know, it's still not what you want to be. It's not the ideal business you want to own, you know.
Yeah. So Peter said, I'm going to catch up soon. And then he said, good night. And then Yan, he says, very cool. These live chats. I'll try to catch up after work. So that's, you guys need to get on it because there's going to be a quiz later. So you better watch them all. I don't know what the funny are. Never mind. Well, we've already filmed like two or three. I guess this is the third show of like 2 hours a piece. So my guess is there's probably not going to be much catching up. I would say you should probably watch the new one. Probably good.
Yeah, or if like they're like, you know, working tomorrow.
Right.
Get some stuff done. Throw one on.
Yeah, when we used to do the live chats, I think that's what a lot of people did, was they used to draw while we were working, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's what everybody should be doing, you know? Get a couple hours in with us.
Yeah, and, I can't imagine anyone's like, you know, actually watching these.
Right. Because then it's like, you know, I mean, because that's kind of what we're trying to do too, is just being real consistent about working at night again, so. What about your parents? I mean, are they supportive of your work and stuff?
Yeah, definitely. They weren't always. My mom definitely has always been, but my dad's kind of like, you know, even though he's kind of a big part of why I got into a lot of it, with like model kits and, you know, animations and like certain like video games and stuff that he kind of got me into as I was younger. You know, that all definitely had a part, but like, and he, you know, he's not, I'm not trying to say he's not supportive, but it's just like, it's not like, you know, it's not like manly work, you know what I mean?
Oh, right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which I think he's not, I don't think he's like that now, but my mom has definitely always been like super, no matter what I've done or whatever, she's always been super into supporting, you know.
Yeah. That's cool. So somebody in the chat, Animagic Wings, says, what advice would you give to younger artists that is very new? What do younger artists need to be more aware of? Want to tackle that one, dude?
Like
how young? That's what I'd like to know. I mean, are we talking like a kid or like somebody who's actually trying to make a living at it? Or
what was the question again? Like, what do they need to do?
Yeah, it says, what advice would you give to a younger artist that's very new? What do younger artists need to be more aware of?
I would just say you got to do the work, man. I don't know. There's really no, like, way to get around that.
Yeah.
If you want to get good and you want to do, you know, if you want to have success, I mean, you definitely got to put the work in and get there. I don't know. What do you think?
Well, that's definitely true. You know, you definitely need to work hard. I think, I'm not sure like what stage, you know, like if you're like a younger guy and you're just trying to learn how to draw, then I think like when I started, you know, I really looked at a lot of like the good artists that I liked and I just tried to really absorb, you know, how they did things and tried to learn from them. And then mm-hmm. I think that kind of gave me, you know, the, you know, talent or whatever. That's sort of like where it came from. Just, you know, looking at, you know, Jack Kirby, Fantastic Four, things like that. Savage Sword Conan. You know what I mean? That's where I learned how to draw in the beginning, was looking at comics and trying to draw like the comic book artists.
Yeah, but like, then, you know, people you admired or whatever.
Yeah. But then like, I don't know, if you're past that stage and you're just, you know, you're trying to get started, I would. It says I'm 23. I'd think like, I mean, if you're just trying to get started in a career, I mean, it's hard to say like what specifically are you going for? If you're wanting to go to work, I mean, that's I guess what I would say, like you gotta, you know, figure out what you want to do and then go towards that, I guess, you know, if you want to work in comics and then you need to start working towards that and really, you know, you got to go through all the hoops. If you want to work somewhere like that, if you want to work for yourself, then you should work towards that. You know, like whatever you start putting your energy towards is where you're going to go, you know? So if you're a guy who wants to paint art, sell at conventions, sell on eBay and stuff like that, then like it's start right now, you know, that's sort of easy. If you want to like work for Marvel Comics or you want to work for some animation studio or something like that, then like put all your focus into that and work towards that, you know?
Yeah.
And then, you know, continue to learn and all that sort of thing.
Yeah. And then, you know, definitely keep absorbing as you go.
Yeah. But I mean, as far as like younger artists, I don't think I can give advice to like what younger artists should do, because I feel like younger artists have like kind of reinvented art. You know what I mean? Like when I was a younger artist, me and Sean were talking about this actually. We went to dinner the other day or lunch. I mean,
Yeah.
Because we're like kind of the same age. And at one time, we were the younger artists around here, you know? And then you go to con, and we were like the young comic book artists that were coming up. Now, we go to conventions. There's all these younger people. We have no clue who they are.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We're like so like out of the loop. We're like the old guys now. And, you know, like none of them follow the same path as us. I mean, the world is so different. You know what I mean? It's like a world of like web comics and independent art now and the internet. And like every day is a convention on the internet. You know what I mean? You don't need to like work for anybody. It's, I don't know. So anything that I learned back in the day, I don't even know that it's, applies anymore, you know, as far as like getting into the business and stuff.
Yeah. But I mean, instead of like meeting, cause you would go to like a convention and like meet the editors and stuff like that there. Right. But I mean, like today, I guess you would just try to like apply that to online or Facebooks or right. Or no.
Well, yeah, back in the day, that's how I got work in comics was I would go to, you know, like San Diego and stuff, show my stuff. And then, you know, I showed it to the right people eventually and got work. And I was also like mail in samples. Nowadays to get into comics, it's just like, I don't really know what the answer would be. I guess something along those lines, right?
Yeah. I mean, you got to get it in front of them, right? I mean, you got to get your work out there. I don't know.
Yeah. I think that's a good tip actually for some artists. Cause there's definitely that still, you know, like back when I was younger, there would be these, you know, you'd run into these guys who were like just phenomenally talented and they would just do absolutely like nothing to sort of advance themselves or get work or, you know, any of that stuff. And they wouldn't, you know, they wouldn't get work because they were sort of like the best kept secret in the town, you know?
Yeah.
So yeah, like if you don't try, you're not gonna get there. But I guess that's all we got to say.
Well, definitely. I don't know. I mean, don't get discouraged because I mean that's gonna happen a lot also.
Yeah.
If you post something online, just don't expect any like response at all. And if you get something, then just be grateful. I mean, cause I mean, a lot of the times, I don't know, like, I guess nowadays, I mean, it's kind of like showing your art. I don't know. Like when you were a kid and you would show your art to people, I mean, I'm sure you'd get a reaction whether it was good or bad right then, but online, I mean, a lot of people just look at your stuff and then they're gone. With, you know, yeah. They're just like scrolling through a feed or whatever. They'll see something, and whether they like it or not, I mean, not everyone's going to take the time to like even click a like button or. I mean, that can be pretty discouraging. Like, you know, especially if you regularly post stuff and like you're not getting any kind of love or anything.
Right.
You could be like, you know, you could just get really discouraged and then stop. And that can be, you know, a great way to not fulfill what you want to do.
You honestly can't stop. I mean, that is really the truth. Like, you know, you can't like stop at any point or, you know, you just guarantee yourself failure, you know, even if, you know, you go, you know, your whole life working for it and you never get it. I don't know. If you stop, then you just guarantee failure. So, I mean, you're right, you know, you have to have those blinders on in a way where you're just so pigheaded that your stuff is going to be good enough and you're going to get where you want to go. You know, it's almost like what we were talking about, like with my mom and stuff, you know, there's just, you know, not that my mom was so bad, but there's, you know, there's just a million people that tell you you can't do it, you know?
Yeah. I mean, especially, you know, you're going to even have friends, I would say, that would, you know, try and talk you out of it.
Absolutely. People that are scared themselves, so they're like speaking out of their own fear. And, you know, just even when you make it, when you get success, you still have people trying to like you know, talk you out of it. It's kind of ridiculous. But yeah, you gotta just be, you know, just pull through it for sure.
Yeah, definitely get a thick skin, I would say. And
yeah. I don't think to me, like, that's not, you know, I mean, it might sound kind of like a downer, but I think that it's actually not, because I look at the web as like the ultimate, like, opportunity anymore. You know what I mean? It's like, even though it's super hard to, like, get a foothold and get an audience and just, you know, you see people, you know, like Sakimi Chan or whoever, who can just, like, put their Patreon out and make 40 grand a year or whatever the hell. It's just like, it's still like, we're all a little bit on the same kind of level playing field, you know, which is the web, which is like this sort of base kind of flat line where you can start to build, you know, and like anybody can come in and anybody can start building an audience and anybody can make it, you know?
Uh-huh.
So like, to me, that's hope, you know? Like, I think back in the day, there was just so much more of like a gatekeeper. There was like so much more of a thing that you had to jump over to get into like publishing. And nowadays, you know, it's just not there. And, you know, because of that, there's just, you know, there's so many more people in it now. But it's also like, I mean, you know, it's right there. It's like, you know, the only person like stopping you from like going out and getting it is yourself, you know? And that to me is like inspiring.
Yeah, I mean, definitely, you're gonna, you know, I would say also like sacrifice, you know, pretty much a social life, really, right?
Give up all your friends.
Every weekend, every waking moment.
Don't expect to get married.
To just, you know, to just make it. I mean,
you're gonna die childless and alone. No, I don't think. I mean, I do think you got to work and give up stuff, but I don't know, though. You can have friends. I've always had hard friends. You know what I mean? Just like now.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, definitely like people on the same mission, but I mean, as far as like, you know, going out and drinking or whatever. Or,
right.
I mean, once in a while, but.
Yeah, maybe you kind of got to give up some of that stuff, but. So let's see what he says here. I try to distance myself from people with their poisoned motivation to move forward is wrong of me with a question mark. Tries to distance himself from people with their poisoned, that try to poison their, his motivation, I think is what he's trying to say.
Good.
And he's asking, is it wrong? I kind of do think that. Because I've definitely run into artists along my journey, you know what I mean? That, you know, they sort of have their own agenda, and they're the kind of guys who, like, they, you know, even if they're artists also, they only want you to succeed if they're succeeding, you know what I mean? That kind of a person.
Yeah.
And then you meet the other kind of people who just, you know, they just want to crap on you for trying, basically. They don't try, so they don't want you to try. And I don't know that there's a way that you can hang with those people indefinitely. Every time I've ever been around one of those people, it ends at some point, and you just have to get away from them and just be like, you know, you got your life, I got my life, you do your thing, I'm over here, you know.
Yeah,
which kind of sucks, but I don't know.
If you can be happy alone. And I don't want to make that sound like sad or whatever, but like, if you can find happiness in solitude, that's another good thing. Like, if you can just create your own fun, basically, with your art, and if you genuinely have fun doing it, you know, that's a great plus, I would say.
I think that's true for sure. If you enjoy it, you're gonna want to do it more. I would say that's another thing that I see, like, you know, kind of going back to the young artist thing. Like, I remember, like, the last time I was at Denver Comic Con, I had several kind of younger type artists come up to me and just kind of strike up a conversation. And they sort of had this attitude, you know, because all my stuff is traditional, like everything I do is traditional. And, you know, like one of them was really, you know, I mean, kind of saying like, you know, I really love traditional, but you know, like you can't make money at it. You know, you can't sort of, you can't make that work. You've got to have the digital side because people want the speed, people want the blah, blah, blah. And then there was another girl who was, you know, they just sort of like, you could just tell they were coming up and they had like hangups that they had gotten from art school. Like, this is how you do it. You know, this is how you do it. That's how they're what they're telling them in art school. And then, you know, they're at the table, like kind of regurgitating like those limitations. And, you know, like, whereas like, you know, to me, like, you know, I don't do digital art. I've never done digital art, and it's never, you know, it's never stopped me from doing anything that I've done, you know? And I think it, you know, it helps me because it's like, if I did do digital art, I wouldn't, you know, be able to sell physical art. And that's like most of my business, you know? So I think that's something to watch out for too, is like, you know, like to not sort of take up those hangups that people have, you know what I mean? Because people like to lump those limitations on you. And like my friend Sean always says, there's no sort of like school teacher there with the ruler that's going to like slap you on the knuckles if you do it wrong. You know what I mean? There is no sort of rules. It's like, if you can find your way in, then that's the right way to do it. You know what I mean? It's not so much like, I don't know, you know? And I see that a lot, especially with like younger people, you know, you hear that a lot, you know, like maybe I was going to say like the 100 Days of Comics kind of guys and stuff, but around where you, I mean, you just always hear it, you know, like, I mean, every time I see a video about comics, like people immediately say, well, you can't make any money with comics. You know what I mean? Just like everybody says that just constantly, can't make any money with comics, can't make any money with comics. But like, you know, like how many times do you see the Kickstarters that like not only make money, but they make a bundle, you know, like the Order of Stick $1 million Kickstarter and, you know, Jason Brubaker and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So it's like, obviously some people can make a shit ton of money doing comics, you know, but back to the point, it's just like those kinds of limitations, you know, just to not let that seep in, you know, when somebody tells you, no, that's, you can't do it that way. That's not right. Make sure that there's a real reason not to do it that way, you know, before you stop and go, oh, okay, I got to play by the rules, you know?
Yeah. I don't know. I agree. I think you shouldn't like, you should find people that are doing something that you really like or you want to do or mimic or kind of not like art styles and stuff, but maybe even a little bit of that. But I'm saying more like, you know, if you want to have like a traditional type of, you know, angle on your work and everything, you should go with that and then find people that are doing that similar thing and then, you know, just bug them and, get their opinion and, you know, try and get them to see your work. A lot of times other artists are, you know, more than happy to look at your stuff. And I mean, and with Instagram and the web, I mean, you can, you know, with Facebook and all that, you can accomplish that really easy nowadays.
I think that is true. And I think that actually does help, you know, like my dad, you know, like he used to like rodeo when he was younger and he used to always like say that to me, like when I was a kid, he's like, you do, you know, like he was talking about roping at the time, but he was like, you compete at like the level that your competition is. So if you like hang out, you know, with like the amateurs, you're going to rope that same way. If you're going to like, you know, everywhere they go, you know, everywhere the pros go and you rope against those guys, you're going to rope at that level. And I think that really is the truth with art. And like, that's what's kind of cool with the internet is because like you can actually put yourself in touch with like people that do comics full time and those sorts of, that sort of level of competition. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Which is, I mean, that's a huge deal. And then,
that's amazing.
You know, and if you could get, you know, feedback and then, you know, take it, you know, if it's someone that you really respect and if they have a critique or, you know, some criticism, you know, take it and go with it. I mean, listen to them, you know what I mean? And I mean, cause it's hard to get like a good honest opinion from like your folks or whatever. I mean, they're always going to be like, oh yeah, that looks great.
So my mom's like, no, you need to quit that shit.
Yeah. Well, aside from Jeff's mom.
No, I do think, you know, but like with criticism, you always got to, you know, take it with a grain of salt because there's always people's opinions mixed in. You know, I listen to all of it, but then, you know, I definitely don't believe all of it, you know. If I did, I'd quit by now, you know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
But, I mean, it's a good point, you know. I always listen, for sure. And I've had, you know.
Well, I'm sure if you were, like, able to get a hold of Frank Frazetta and he was like, all right, Jeff, this is how.
I would, you know, listen, for sure.
You should be like, you know, this is how you draw a hand. I don't know what the hell you're doing, but this is how you do it. You know, I'm sure you'd listen with a closer ear, you know.
I've definitely had those critiques, not from Frank Frazetta, but I've had them from, like, you know, really good artists and stuff and guys I've respected. And I've also had, like, bad critiques from, like, guys that, you know, like I said, respected, and it's just, like, heartbreaking. And, you know, it's like, it's kind of the same thing. You got to take it with a grain of salt. Those guys aren't always trying to do what you're doing. And, you know, I take some of it, and then sometimes I don't listen. I just go like, that's good for you, but I'm doing something else, you know? So,
yeah.
But I think you're right. Talking to like pros and stuff, I mean, it's just invaluable in a way because like those are the guys that get work. They can tell you how they get work. They can tell you how they do it. And that's just easier.
At the very least, you can learn how they do, you know, because a lot of times, you know, they'll be more than happy to tell you how they do certain things, and you could just, like, you know, take little things from that and modify it.
Yeah.
Even if you can't see their work, just talking to them, even if you can't show them your work, there's still, like, valuable information you can get from, especially, like, you know, tutorials and everything nowadays.
Yeah. So who's this? Hibiku Kazi. I mix my time between traditional and digital, and I see limitations as a goal to work past. Cool. I like that. And then Anna Magic Wing said thanks. Do you got, like, a channel, dude? I mean, so with some animation on it? I mean, if you do, you gotta. I mean, I can't really click on your link or whatever, but I'd like to check out your stuff, though. It'd be pretty cool. I'm always looking for new animators that, you know, doing cool stuff, because I just love stop motion and stuff.
Yeah, definitely. I am as well.
Yeah. And I think I recognize that Hibiku Kaze. I wonder if he does videos or something, because that sounds like a real familiar name. I might have came across your channel at some point. So what you sculpting over there?
I don't know yet. I'm trying to do I was just kind of goofing around because I didn't really have anything planned. I was going to paint Yoda, but then I was like, well, just, you know, I kind of want to make molds of him now.
Cool.
So I didn't want to do that because that's like, you know, that's not something I can do on camera.
Right.
But now it's just kind of like, I don't know. I was thinking about doing like a girl with like a cat on her shoulder.
Cool.
Which I know it doesn't make any sense, but.
Well, if it's a cool looking girl with a cool looking cat, I could see it.
Yeah, just, you know. I haven't sculpted a whole ton of girls.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of just trying to sketch out a really quick female. But then now that, you know, I had a cartoonier style in mind, but I'm going a little bit too realistic.
Yeah.
And now I'm like, now, and then like the expression that I've just naturally been giving her is kind of not really happy to see a cat. So I don't know if I should change it or have the cat have another weird expression on his face.
Yeah. So that Hibiku Kaze, he says, I'm Logan from the 100 Days of Comics. I wrote the Mechanos. That's cool. Yeah, that's probably where I saw the name, that forum or whatever. I might have watched some of your videos. And then the other guy says, I haven't posted for years, but I really need to get into it again. Yeah, definitely. Says, I have a channel for a year or a place where I post art, and then I change the name and start a new place.
What are you working on, man? You still working on Wonder Woman?
Yeah. Can I get this one down?
Sweet. How's she coming along?
I think it's looking pretty decent.
Yeah, it's looking awesome.
Thanks.
I like what you're doing with the colors.
I'm hoping I could get it done tonight. That'd be cool. Start on something new tomorrow, maybe.
Yeah. How'd your, did you go do the thing with your dad today?
Yeah. Went over there this morning. Just fine. Went and had some lunch afterwards, which is good.
Is it just you and him, or did you take Tristan? Or
no, we had to like vaccinate some cows and dehorn them and stuff. So I don't know. I didn't want to bring him for all that, you know.
Is he in school right now, or is he out of school? Is it summer break or whatever?
Yeah, he's out. He's out. He also went to Waterworld, you know, like yesterday, so he was like really tired last night. So I just thought I'll probably sneak out before he gets up, and that's kind of what happened. So
the one in like Westminster or whatever.
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. I grew up near there, but I never ever went to. I've never actually been inside there.
Oh, really?
I used to drive this motorbike I had in the parking lot.
Oh, wow. So you're like way up there then?
Well, yeah, it was definitely, I was roughly 104th and Federal is where I grew up.
Okay.
And like my grandma, she was kind of closer to that water world.
Yeah. Yeah, it's fun. Fun going up there. I go once in a while. It is expensive. Like, they buy like.
Is it worse than Illich's or what?
I don't know how much Illich costs anymore, but like Tanya and them go up like so often that they buy like the year pass or whatever.
Yeah.
And then like when they get that year pass, then there's like some free passes in there. So I usually go like two or three times with them. Just pretty fun.
Is it, down is it like
scary rides?
Is it just like water slides and stuff, or they have like actual rides you go on, kind of like Disneyland or something?
No, I mean it's mainly water slides, but they're like just really crazy water slides, you know. And then they have like one roller coaster, which is kind of like a roller coaster that goes around in the water.
Yeah,
it's kind of like, you know, if you're a roller coaster fan, it's kind of like a lame roller coaster, but like Tristan loves it. It's like this perfect speed for like him and his age and stuff, you know.
It goes through the water? That sounds badass.
Yeah, well, it rides on the water. It's sort of like the log ride at, you know, wherever, Disneyland or something. So you're like in this roller coaster that's in the water, but then it's going really fast. Yeah.
That's awesome, man. Splash Mountain's like probably one of my favorite rides.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of like that.
Do they have a bunch of animatronics?
Well, no, that's that thing is just a roller coaster. But then they also have these other rides that are like you get in these big inner tubes and you kind of go along this, you know, river kind of thing that kind of slowly meanders back and forth. And you go into these caves and there's sort of like the Indiana Jones type music playing in there. And there's all these mummies and stuff. And, you know, that's where there's sort of like the animatronic kind of stuff, you know, and that's kind of neat. Those are the ones that actually scare him, though. It's funny, like, you know, like he'll go down like the craziest slide, but he doesn't like going in and seeing like the mummies. But he always goes anyway. But then he closes his eyes when we go by like certain parts. I have to warn him.
Do you have to go with him for him to go on?
Yeah, he doesn't like to go on that one by himself. But like with all the big slides, he always wants me to go with him. Like, so like a lot of times the slides will be side by side. So we'll go like down together. You know what I mean? He'll get on one side, I'll go on the other side. Yeah. They have this one that's really fun where you get on this mat and then there's like these tubes that are just crazy. And you sort of race through these tubes and try to race out the bottom and see who gets there first. So like whenever we go, we always have to go on that thing like 100 times, you know. We just go over and over and over and over, you know. Till Tanya's like, we have to leave.
How are the lines there?
It's a lot of fun. Well, if we go during the week, they're not that bad. I mean, we went one time on the weekend and it was just like, oh my God, you know, just lines for everything. But, you know, where I don't work, it's sort of like we can go anytime. So a lot of times we'll go just like on a Tuesday or something and they won't be so bad. You know?
That's awesome.
And they have like the giant like wave pool. Tristan really likes that. Go out there and get half drowned, you know, and stuff. Yeah, it's fun, you know, like, I mean, I used to like going to that kind of stuff as a kid, and then, you know, like, you just don't do it anymore when you get to be an adult, and then, like, when Tristan came along now, it's like, he gives you the excuse to go and have fun again, you know?
Yeah.
So that's really neat. That's why you need some kids, man.
As soon as Sean's kid gets a little bit bigger, you can,
yeah.
I'll go out there.
Yeah, I can't wait till he gets a little bigger. I hope that I get to go over and, like, play with him a little bit and stuff.
I'm sure him and Tristan are going to be buddies for life.
I don't know. I mean, Tristan's like 6 and he's like 0. So that's like a pretty big age gap. It'd be cool to think that they would be, but I don't know. It's hard to say what will happen. Tristan doesn't care much for babies right now. You know what I mean? It's kind of like you could take them or leave them. He sent me some pictures, Sean did, like, I guess this morning. I haven't really looked at my email, but I clicked it open. He sent me a bunch of pictures of the little guy. He's really cute. He's like, yeah. He looks a lot like his wife, Monica. Like, if you look at his face,
uh-huh.
And then, like, eyes look a lot like Sean's. You know, it's funny. It's like a mix.
I messaged him today and congratulated him and everything, and he sent me a picture of him. He was like sleeping. He was like super cute looking.
Yeah, that's awesome. Really neat.
Yeah, he seems like he's having a blast with him.
Yeah. Yeah, I wonder what it's like over there. I mean, I remember bringing Tristan home for those first few days, you know, when you first have like the first kid, and it's like, woo, you know, a lot of stress. A lot of sleepless nights and all that kind of good stuff.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm trying to like do eyeballs right now.
Oh, no, so that's fine.
I'm like in a focused mode here. What does your dad think of your stop motion short that you did, the first episode there?
Yeah, I don't think my dad's ever seen it. I mean, I'm sure I've mentioned it to him, like we talk and stuff, but I don't think I've ever really brought it and showed it to him or anything.
No?
Yeah. Oh, man. It's not like I'm keeping it from him or anything. It's just, I don't know, it's just not, you know, the stuff we really talk about. I don't think he's ever seen any of my YouTube videos for sure or anything like that, so.
Have you shown any of your family members your animation? That's freaking awesome, man.
Well, my brother's seen it. You know, he thought it was really cool. My mom's seen it. She thought it was awesome, you know. That's about it. I mean, you know, some other people might have seen it just from seeing stuff on my website, you know, like sometimes like when we go to Christmas, like they'll start talking to me about stuff. But I was like, do you know about that? And then, you know, so some of them like follow me a little bit online, I think.
Yeah.
And I don't know. They saw my art book. I gave them copies of that. So that's sort of like what they're all into right now, you know, if they're into anything. But
yeah, it's cool to have, you know, not many people have, you know, art books, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Somebody says, can I get a link to my stop motion short? If you click on my channel and you scroll down to like, there's like a stop motion playlist right there. And I think it's like always the first one on there. I mean, I guess I can hunt one up. Let's see. It'll probably be there by the time I get this. Paste it. There it is there. So what's your parents think about you like quitting and all that and going out on your own? They're deathly afraid of what's gonna happen to you?
No, I mean, I think they both know that if I just put the time in that I'll make it work somehow.
Yeah.
I think, you know, I definitely think they believe in me and all that.
That's cool.
You know, I don't know if necessarily my dad thinks it's the best thing, but.
Well, what would he think would be like the best thing, like in his mind?
I'm sure in his mind he'd probably still want me to just go back to painting with him, you know?
Oh, painting houses.
Yeah.
That's like such a, I mean, I guess like there's people that can make it work, but it almost seems like if you're like a painter, like a real painter, I mean, it's almost like there's only one way out, and that's get too old and can't do it anymore and all that. Like if you're a businessman type guy, like my old boss, then you can make it work. But unless you're that kind of guy who just sits around and counts pennies all day, then I don't know. Painting just seems to be almost like a dead end.
Yeah, I you know, there's definitely people who can make it work, but
yeah,
you know, my dad is definitely, you know, he's made it work for 30 years or whatever.
Yeah.
And I know I could make it work. I mean, you know, I did it with him for a long, long time.
Well, I'm sure.
And then once it all fell out and I kind of went and started doing my own thing, I made that work too.
Yeah.
Like with the whole NDT, you know?
Yeah.
And I don't think he really knows how much I made doing that.
He'd be like, what are you, crazy?
Yeah, I think if they knew,
You know? Go back right now.
Take me by the ear right back to Vestas.
Well, more money's more problems, right? Don't want that job.
It's true. Especially if I was married, I think I could pocket more. But I was just paying so much in taxes and.
Oh hell yeah, dude!
They're getting me good.
I totally remember when I used to paint and was single, and you know, just talking to the older guys, and be like, "Tax return? Yeah, how do you get something back?" And they'd all be like, "You need to have a kid." It's a big difference. Got to get that going there, going next. Hear that, everybody? Mike's on the market. Need to get him a girlfriend. Are you still there?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Sorry.
Okay. I shocked you in the silence. Shut the fuck up.
No, I'm working on these eyes, and I'm trying to, like, you know, it's actually fun working on a female face. Yeah. But it's also like tougher because I'm trying to do it like I was going in a more realistic style, but now I'm kind of keeping it realistic but kind of cartoony as well. But it's different than doing a guy's face, that's for sure.
Yeah.
What are your tips on, aside from like bone structure and the obvious differences?
I mean, I always feel like female faces are harder. Because like they're more perfect, and that's harder to paint. It's easier to paint things that are imperfect, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
Because you can hang, you know, the structure of the thing on there. But you get that opulent skin and like, you know, hardly any shadows and stuff, and it's hard to make that look perfect because there's just not that much to draw, you know. But
yeah, you need some beard and some scars you can hide behind.
Exactly. Some wrinkles and stuff. So I don't know. I still like drawing women though, so I don't know. Well, broke it off. I went to the art store today and no color pencils. None of my freaking black color pencils are out. It makes me so mad when that happens. It's like, God, you're an art store. How can you run out of black color pencils for Christ's sake? Did anybody ever like check the stock there? You know what I mean?
Hey Frank, we're running low on charcoal.
Plenty of pink. That does be a hell of a lot of good. No, I'm kidding. There's a guy down there that I kind of talk to now, so I shouldn't be busting on it. I know he watches some of my videos too. So he'll probably be like, yeah, we're never getting black now. But he was in there talking to me. He was actually kind of brought up. It's funny, like how some people will you can tell they got something on their mind. And then when you like open it up, they just launch into it. That was like today. Cause he does like music and stuff. And I think, you know, he has gotten so that he plays for different bands and gets paid for it and stuff. So he makes extra money doing it that way.
Yeah.
And, but then he kind of was like talking like me almost where it's like, yeah, it's like, you know, I make money and it kind of takes up all my time, but then I don't want, you know, I want to do like my own stuff. I want to do, you know, this specific thing. I'm not that much into like what I'm getting paid for. It's kind of a drag. So it just kind of launches right into that today.
Uh-huh.
So I just was listening and agreeing and stuff. He's a nice guy. I've known him for like years.
He's trying to be a musician then?
Well, I mean, he's older. I think he's just kind of like me. He's just, you know, like we're like me when I was working where it's just like I make money doing this, so why not do it and make money, you know what I mean? So it's like more of like an extra money thing. I don't think he's like thinking about quitting or anything because he's probably older than I'd say he's probably older than me, but I just think he's just frustrated creatively, frustrated a little bit, you know.
Yeah, There's no, that's another thing, like the discouraging thing, like the older you get to, you get more worried about, you know, you feel like your chance is slipping away or whatever.
Yeah.
But I don't think that's true. Cause I mean, there's plenty of examples you could point to of people who are older and they made it work, you know. I have this buddy who's worried that he's not going to be able to make it now because he's getting older. He's trying to be a musician, you know, mm-hmm. which maybe it is a little bit more true in that field of art, you know what I mean? But, you know, I still think that's not the case.
Yeah, to
be a performing artist.
I don't know. Like, it's so hard to just, like, you know, when you say make it, like, you know, like, what does that, you know, entail or whatever? Like, to me, you know, it's just different, like, the making a thing than just to, like, make a living at it. I think, you know, there's a good possibility you can make a living at a lot of things at lots of different stages in life, but to really become, like, a superstar, man, it's just so hard to figure out how to do that or do it, and you know what I mean? I think all that stuff kind of plays into it.
Yeah.
And that kind of sucks. I've felt that too. Like, oh, my chances are past. Like, all the people I've known, you know, it's like they're at the end of their career. You're just like still trying, you know, it sucks. But I don't know what else I would do.
Yeah.
And they could say, I'm done, walk out the door. But then what do I do tomorrow? You know? Probably going to kick my sketchbook open and draw something. Well, then I'm back in business. Can't quit, you know? It's just, you know, it's your hobby. It's your business. It's just your passion, I guess. So may as well keep going.
Yeah.
Hopefully, you know, you die with the sketch just halfway through a piece and just fall over dead. That's the way I want to go. I don't want to be eaten by a bear or something.
Well, you know why?
Didn't mean to bring that up. My mom was talking about one, or not my mom. What am I saying? My mom, my wife was talking about. That sounds terrible. She's gotten on this kick where she's like, Tristan's never been camping before. I'm like, camping? Camping? Like right after.
Watch these Bigfoot documentaries.
Right. Right after we had the Bigfoot show last night. Yeah.
Watch one.
I don't think I'm into this.
Watch one of those, and then let's see if we're still going to go camping. So she wants Tristan to go camping? And you're against it, or what?
Well, I don't know. That's kind of what it sounds like. She wants to go camping, but I'm just like, I don't know, man. I'm not sure. I think she almost wants to go just because she knows I'm going to say no. Because I know how she is, and, you know, she definitely can complain. You know, it's like, just not sure if she's really going to want to go rough it for a weekend or something.
Yeah.
But who knows?
What does Tristan think? Does he even know what it is? Or
nobody's even brought it up to him yet. So I'm sure it would be fun. But
I never did a lot of camping growing up.
We went on, like, my dad was definitely not a big camper. We went on like one vacation. I thought it was a blast. To Mesa Verde when I was, you know, I don't know, fourth grade or something.
Yeah.
But then, I don't know. I had a girlfriend that for a while, and she went camping with her all the time, and that was a kick, but I think it's just more, you know, being all young and in love kind of thing, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm sure if you had a girlfriend, camping's a lot more interesting.
Yeah. Whereas, yeah, dragon, I don't know. This is a little, it's a lot of stuff you got to drag out, and get ready for. I don't know. I'm just sort of like the soft, nerdy artist now. Not as much of into like in all of mountains anymore.
Yeah, you gotta like watch tutorials on how to fish and all. I mean, sounds like a whole thing. We did like the other day, probably a couple weeks ago, we you know, there was this big rainstorm and it broke a bunch of, you know, dead branches off around the area.
Yeah.
So we got a bunch of them and started a jeez.
What? This sounds good.
We got a bunch of them and, you know, the pieces of, you know, wood that fell and stuff, and yeah, we started a little fire. And which, I mean, it wasn't that hard to start a fire, but it was like a bit of a challenge for, you know, like to keep it going or whatever, and then also like, you know, we started like cook some hot dogs and stuff over it.
Oh, okay.
And apparently that's, you know, frowned upon.
Cooking hot dogs over fire? Why?
Well, like, you know, without like telling the fire department or whatever.
Oh, you guys just did this all in like town or something?
Yeah, like in the backyard.
So the fire department actually came and like made you put out your hot dog fire?
No, but there's like this like homeowners, like, I don't know what they call them. It's like this, you know, this thing that the area, this like patrol, it's not like police, yeah, they're like security guards kind of. They're like driving around, but they're like driving around in old cop cars.
Really?
And they like, you know, he stopped and he was like, you know, he was getting ready to give me a bunch of crap. And I was like, man, you're going to have to go get like real.
I want the real cops here. That's hilarious. Yeah, you guys need to get a barbecue, dude. You can like barbecue your hot dogs.
Yeah, it's probably better. I mean, I sound like, you know, I sound like an ashtray for forever.
Yeah, totally. That's what it's like when you're camping. You always get the smoke on and stuff.
Yeah. And then, like, you know, it's like, how do you cook the damn things? Like, I kept sticking, like, skewers through them, and they kept falling through. And
oh, really?
I don't know. Finally figured it out, but it's just like, man.
Well, when we used to go camping, I used to always bring a little gas, like, stove thing. It was this little stove that you could light up, you know, cook on top of that. You got some burners and stuff.
Like a charcoal thing or just like a propane?
Yeah, it just hooked into like a little propane bottle. So.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I've seen those at like Walmart and stuff.
Yeah.
Does that work pretty good?
Yeah, it works. It works awesome. It's just like a little tiny stove, you know. Because like me and my brother actually used to go fishing a lot. I was thinking like I never went camping, but actually I've been camping with him like quite a few times. So.
To go fishing and stuff?
Yeah, going fishing around different places.
Have you ever been hunting?
Yeah, he really likes to hunt, so I used to go with him a lot. So,
well, I remember your javelina story, but...
Yeah. Wait, I didn't... Oh, seeing him. Yeah, we didn't... I didn't shoot a javelina for sure. I saw him outside that hotel. I don't think we were hunting. Why was I at that hotel? Was that a hunting story? It might have been.
Yeah, well, you're... I thought you said you... What was that creature you said you were saying? And then you freaked out. Wasn't that when you guys were hunting for javelinas in Arizona?
No. We never... I saw those in... We were in a hotel in... I can't remember the name of the town. It's like south of Grand Junction, like way south.
like where it turns into fucking desert. And but it, I, we weren't fishing because it's like me and Keith would never get a hotel when we fish. We we'd either camp out or sleep in the car. But yeah, that's where I saw the javelinas.
Oh, okay. I thought you were in Arizona and you seen them when you seen like that creature or whatever that you wanted to go back and see.
No, that was also in Colorado. That's like when we thought we saw the Wolverine.
That's what it was.
Nobody believes that it's a Wolverine, but I still think that thing did not look like, I mean, it just was the weirdest looking creature. I don't know. Maybe it was like a deformed bear or something, but it looked like a Wolverine, dude. It had like long freaking claws, like long claws. It was like humped over on the back, had this like kind of pig looking nose and was all hairy.
Sounds like a chupacabra.
Had this like hairy tail. I just was wandering across the edge of this canyon when we were like thinking about like hiking down this canyon. There's like this canyon that's called like Canyon of the. It's like the Black Canyon of the Gunnison or something like that, or the Black Gunnison or something. But it's like by the Gunnison River. And it's like a really crazy canyon. Me and Keith were like, we were actually going to hike down, fish this river, which was supposed to be really great fishing. And then camp down there and come back. And it was just like, we pull up. I mean, it's like freaking desert out here, which I'm not a fan of deserts. I really don't like deserts. And like every step, just from the car to the rim of this canyon, just every step is like four lizards jumping away from you. I'm just like, oh my God, I don't like lizards. I don't like snakes. And then the canyon is like, fucking, you know, it's like something out of like, you know, the Butch Cassidy and Sundance Kid movie or something. I mean, it's like straight down. And I'm like, I don't know if we can get back out of there if we actually get down, you know?
Yeah.
So we're like looking at it for a long time. And then like, you know, out of the brush comes this freaking Wolverine looking, whatever the hell it was, walking across there. And Keith's like, what the fuck is it? What the hell is that? And I'm like, you know, looking at some lizard. I'm like, lizard. He's like, that's not a lizard. I look over. I'm like, what the hell is that thing? You know? And we like watch it, and it just goes off across and goes into a different place. I mean, it was definitely a wild off the road place, but we like told it to a couple different people. One time, I told it to told that story to like this wildlife guy.
Yeah.
And he just was like, he looked at me like I had just seen Bigfoot. You know, he just had this like skeptical look like, yeah, right. And then he told me, yeah, there's no Wolverines in Colorado. And then that was it. So, well, what the hell was it then?
What did he think it was? Just a deformed bear?
He didn't have any answer for me. He just, that was it. That was the end of conversation. Yeah, there's no Wolverines in Colorado. And he just kind of turned around.
Probably thought you were like high or something.
Yeah. Those were actually fun times. That was like when my brother just, you know, like they just had their first kid and we were all kind of young enough that we're still just goofing around all the time. And so like me and him were always going, you know, like he really liked to bow hunt. I like to shoot a lot too. So I'd always go with him. And then we'd go fishing all the time and stuff. So those were some
fun times. Bow hunting. Did you ever go bow hunting?
Yeah, I've been with him lots of times.
Like where you were shooting the bow too, or? Just kind of like around.
Oh yeah, I mean, I have a bow and I shoot all the time. We used to go to like these shoots all the time, and that was fun. But then I don't know. I just don't really like hunting. I mean, I've shot like a couple rabbits and stuff, and I like hunting, but I don't like killing stuff. So I just never dug the whole deer hunting thing and stuff. So
yeah,
I kind of go along with him and stuff, but just not really ever hunt seriously, you know?
Yeah.
One time we were painting, actually, this is a weird story. And I just had this crazy, this was right when I went to work for Joe
And Joe, you know, it's a stupid company. So it's always full of so many weirdos. But anyway, I get stuck with this one foreman. He's just like nuts. You know what I mean? He's just like, everything is just, he's just so fucking weird. Everything is just always some weird thing. So we're like at the Boulder Reservoir, actually, fixing like the bathrooms or something, or I can't remember, something up there with the restaurant and stuff.
Yeah.
And lunchtime comes around and he's like, come on, come home with me for lunch. And I'm like, the guy. This guy named Sean. And I'm like, and I got lunch. I don't, you know, and I didn't like him, so I didn't really want to go hang out with him during lunch. He's like, no, come home with me for lunch or whatever. So he like convinces me to come home with him. So he lives kind of out there by the Boulder Res. And he gets out. So we're like eating lunch. You know, his girlfriend makes us lunch in the kitchen there. And then he gets out like this 22. So like, come on, let's go shoot some gophers or prairie dogs. And I'm like, you know, like this is Boulder. You know, it's like fucking prairie dogs are almost like an endangered species here. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, they pretty much transplant them here. And I'm like, dude, I don't think this is like, like, come on. He goes out to like his back fence and he's like shooting at these prairie dogs, you know?
Oh my God.
And so he like hands me the rifle. He's like, take a shot and all this. And I aim at one and I'm just like, I'll just shoot down there by him. And so like, I got to shoot and I just, you know, of course I just like nail one. And I'm like, oh God, you know, I felt all bad about it. You know, I'm like, oh, just like, you know, what a crappy day at work. I didn't want to go to your house for lunch. You actually didn't want to kill a prairie dog. You know what I mean? You guys are just such a fucking wacko, dude.
What a horrible tale.
Yeah.
There was a, I don't know. My dad told me a story one time when he was younger, he had a Mustang and he would drive it really fast down these like, you know, residential roads, which you're not supposed to do, obviously. And like he was driving and he hit these pigeons and killed them.
Oh man.
And he felt really bad. And then, you know, and then like a couple weeks later, he's driving again and he hits another cluster of pigeons. And he just felt horrible about it. And I was just like, man, that's, and then that just reminds me of, have you ever seen that Seinfeld episode where like George hits the squirrel?
Oh yeah.
And he's like, yeah. We have a deal with the pigeons. You know, they need to move.
Right.
And then he actually hits the squirrel and they're like doing everything they can to save it.
Yeah.
Then he like,
that's hilarious.
He like goes into the room to visit it and the doctor's like, you have a half an hour.
Yeah. Well, doesn't in the end of that one, or is that actually the squirrel where he charges it and then he stomps it and like the kid and the mom are like, oh my God, why did you do that or whatever?
What was it? Oh, he stomped. Did he stomp the squirrel or did he stomp the pigeon?
I thought it was pigeons, but maybe it was squirrels because, you know.
I remember the squirrel. I remember the squirrel was in the hospital bed and his girlfriend really wanted him to save it. And so he paid all this money to like get these little utensils just flown in and all this stuff.
All right.
And then like, I remember it was funny because the little squirrel tail was like hanging out of the bed.
That's Seinfeld, man. That show's so funny.
But that was just like, it reminded me of that. My dad said he felt horrible for, you know, killing the pigeon.
Yeah.
And I think, isn't, pigeons have something to do with Mike Tyson, too. Thinking Mike about
Tyson?
It. Yeah, like.
Like what?
When he was younger, he had a whole bunch of pet pigeons. And these guys like killed his pigeons or something, and then that's what made him learn how to box.
Oh wow.
Something like that. That sounds kinda lame, but I think it is something like that.
That sounds like a great movie. Like Karate Kid kind of thing. Take revenge on the pigeon killings.
Because they were like his best friends. Like
blood sport after that. Hunts them down one by one, like, you know, sudden impact takes him out. I want to see that movie.
Sounds like a Mad Max type of deal.
Definitely. Have you ever went hunting or anything like that?
No, I've never hunted. I've went and shot like BB gun, but
yeah,
I've never like went hunt, you know, actual hunting or anything.
Yeah.
We've went, I guess fishing is hunting, right? So I guess I've.
Well, I always consider that fishing, but yeah.
I've been fishing before.
Yeah. I actually like fishing.
Yeah, I don't know. I know there's like lots of people like Andy Griffith, like that's, you know, the kids from that show would just like would get done with school and they would race home.
Yeah.
Like, and also, and like, you know, Little House on the Prairie too. That's like, that's what they would do for fun.
Sure.
I was just like, I don't know. I never found it that much fun, but, you know, I never found myself like looking at a clock waiting for it to tick down so I could race up and go fishing, but, you know, and also it's never any fun because I never would catch anything, so. Just feel like an idiot for a few hours.
Yeah, it's not fun if you're like somewhere that, you know, it's hard to catch fish and stuff. But when me and Keith did it, we used to always go like all over the place looking for great spots and stuff. And I don't know. It's part of the fun, I think.
That sounds like fun, yeah. Also, if like doing it with like family and stuff like that.
Yeah.
My mom and dad used to like, they used to be really into fishing. My dad would always try to catch northern pike or tiger muskies.
Yeah.
But he would like usually go out on like a belly boat.
Yeah.
And that looked like fun, but I could never go out on it. So I would just like be stuck on shore with my mom.
Oh, that sucks. Keith's got, because he still does it, but he's got a little canoe type thing that he goes out in, which is really funny because Keith, like, you know, when we were kids, he was like terrified of water and didn't like to swim or nothing. And I'm always like, man, you go out in that thing, you know? It's kind of funny because he's like into that outdoor type stuff. And like, even when we were still like fishing and stuff like that, Keith was always like kind of like scared of the dark a little bit. And, you know, we'd be like fishing and he'd always be like, come on, let's go. You know, I'd be like, come more times. It's starting to get hot finally. You know what I mean? And I'd always have him out there till it was like pitch fucking black, and then we'd be like walking back to the woods, and he'd just be like fucking terrified, you know. I remember this one time, I swear to God, he was going to kill me. We're at this reservoir that's around here by Boulder called Gross Reservoir, and you know, like the fishing on the one side is okay, but it's like way better if you go around to like the side that's got the canyon on it that nobody goes to, you know. So we go over to that side, we hike down this big old canyon, we're fishing, getting dark, and then it's like, then we got to hike up to the car, which is like up a mountain, and you know, it was like just pitch black. We were like killing ourselves trying to get up this thing, like no trail or nothing. And like Keith was just like going 100 miles an hour. I'm like, fucking wait up, man. That's pretty funny.
We're gonna die.
Right.
There's deformed bears everywhere. Yeah, right.
Wolverine.
Deformed bear, that would be a horrible thing to see too. I mean, there's just a lot of scary things in the woods, man. I could kind of see why he was a little apprehensive.
Yeah. Well, like when I did that delivery job, you know, like I, same thing. Like me and Keith used to do that kind of stuff. I've never seen like a bear like in Colorado up to that point. You know what I mean? It's like we drove all over the Colorado, all over these crazy mountains and stuff. Never saw one. Never saw a mountain lion. And then when I had that delivery drive route, that guy that was like teaching me the route
told me, you know, because it goes up in the mountains. And he was just like immediately telling me, he's like, oh yeah, you're going to see bear. You're going to see, you know, fucking, I think I've told the story a million times too, but I guess you guys have heard all my stories. So whatever, strap in, here it comes again. But you're going to see bear. You're going to see, you know, mountain lion. You're going to see fucking like zebras. You're going to see like wildebeest running across here. You know, like every animal in the world. You know, you're going to fucking see tigers.
Wildebeest?
Yeah.
Wow.
He's just throwing out everything. And I'm like, yeah, right. You know? And then, like, man, like 3 days into driving that thing, like, this huge bear runs up in front of my car. And I'm like, what the fuck, you know? And then it was just, like, all the time. Like, when you drive around in the mountains at night, like, they're fucking everywhere. And, like, I've seen, like, mountain lion, like, just, like, right at the edge of Boulder. You know what I mean? I've seen them all up and down the canyons. Like, one time I was driving through Jamestown, and this one was just, like, he's just, like, trotting along beside my car. Like, it was nothing. Like, right through town, you know?
A mountain lion?
A mountain lion, yeah.
Oh, my God.
And, like, I've seen, like, bobcat and stuff up there. It's just weird. Like, you know, like, all the animals that you think are out there, you think, well, maybe they're out there. They're totally out there, but you just don't see them, like, during the day, you know?
That's horrifying.
That's right.
I've seen some, like, mountain lion tracks. You know, when I was staying at my folks up in Florence, you know, years ago, there was like mountain lion tracks and stuff out there, like outside my truck.
Yeah.
But I'd never like, you know, and sometimes I would hear them, like you could hear them like that, you know, that roar, whatever they do, that like, whatever that sound is.
Yeah.
It's like a broken motorcycle.
That's like that Florence area I know has. Like, I think that's even, like, the height of, like, the population in, like, Colorado or something. Because I knew guys that hunted mountain lion, and that's, like, the area where they would hunt them, like, around Canyon City and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So, I know they're down there.
Well, and then there's, like, you know, my folks have, you know, told me that, you know, they'll take the trash out, and then they'll come out, and they'll, you know. I've seen plenty of deer there. But, you know, they've even said they've seen mooses, like, you know, rummaging through trash, and then, like, bears will go through the trash. And I was like, oh, my God, man, that's – I know a bear probably wouldn't attack you unless he was, like, super hungry or whatever, but still, man. I seen The Edge when I was a little kid, and it scared the hell out of me.
Yeah, that's a good movie. I love that movie. That's right.
We don't – they don't have Kodiaks in Colorado, right? That's, like – Alaska and stuff.
No. Yeah, they don't even have grizzly bears, but I tell you, I've seen some big ass black bears up by Estes Park and stuff.
Yeah,
like I remember how this big, one, like,
he was 200 or 300 pounds.
Well, I used to have a Dodge Dakota. That was what I used to drive up there. And yeah, I don't know what poundage this would be, but there was one time I saw, and this was probably the biggest one I've ever seen, and he just trucked right in front of my truck, just walking. And, like, totally just nonchalant. His back was just, like, the height of my hood. You know what I mean? Oh, and that's, like, you know, Dodge Dakota. I mean, it's, like, still a small truck, but it's, like, one of the bigger small trucks. So it was, like, four-wheel drive and everything. That thing was huge. I mean, if I just saw that anywhere, I'd have been like, oh, that's fucking grizzly bear. You know? I would, I mean, could you imagine, yeah, screw this camp and shit. I'm not going to. I just think, I mean, that was like kind of spooky to see him in the car. I don't want to see that thing outside my vehicle, man. He's probably still up there. He's probably waiting for me to come back.
He's just waiting for that. What were you delivering, papers?
Yeah, like at that time I was, yeah.
I was going to say, if you're like delivering like, you know, Dunkin' Donuts or something. Or what are bears like berries and stuff?
Or like they like fish? People. They like people, dude.
Oh, that's true. Like human beings.
I mean, bears like eat everything. They're like omnivores or whatever. But yeah, I think they like live on a ton of berries, and they bust up the old logs and go through looking for bugs and stuff.
Bears can run fast, man. Right? I've seen some videos of them like booking.
And I saw this one video of a bear, and he went out into like the middle of this elk herd,
and then was just kind of wandering around the elk. We're all getting kind of uptight and stuff. And then all of a sudden, he's like blast, just like full speed, charges this like elk calf, tackles him, starts eating on him. It was just like, oh my God, man.
Oh, jeez. Did you ever see that video of the guy on the bike? He's like, you know, pedaling around, and then this bear starts chasing him.
I remember you showing me that.
Oh, did I show it to you? That like terrified me, man.
That was totally fake, though.
I remember you saying it was fake, but I was like, I don't know, man.
That was totally fake.
Just picturing that's like true, though. I mean, that's scary.
That would be pretty spooky. Turn on the afterburners. He'd probably run you down easy, even on a bike, I would imagine. I know a mountain lion, just like their kind of speed. I don't think you'd have any shot if they decided to take you. But I think that's the thing, is like most wildlife is not that aggressive, really. They don't really mess with you unless you are messing with them, you know?
Yeah. I do agree. I think a mountain lion could catch you pretty fast.
I mean, just think of your house cat, you know? Crazy like ninja nutcase off the top of the refrigerator, you know, onto your table, and then, you know, back without, you know, even blinking an eye.
Yeah.
Just think of that thing in the woods, you know.
Probably just be frozen with fear and then get eaten.
I'd like whip out my Bowie knife and be like fighting for my life. Rah! Like Davy Crockett.
Did you ever see that Grizzly Man documentary? Like, I don't know if it was a documentary.
Oh, yeah. Totally. That's creepy as hell.
Do you think that was all, like, real? Or do you think any of that was fake?
Oh, no. I think that was all real. How would they fake that kind of stuff?
Guy, like... You know, well, they never show, like, him getting eaten or whatever. They show, like, him listening to the audio with the mom or the whatever.
Yeah.
Right? And then, like, that I don't know, that director, he just seemed like kind of a shady guy. I don't know.
Well, it was a true story. I don't know that it – I don't remember honestly hearing about it before – the movie, though. But
I know it's like, it definitely, like, him like living out there with the bears and stuff, I could definitely see that, you know. Yeah, sure, one day, yeah, one of them ate him. Totally believable,
right? And I mean, there was tons of footage of him out there basically being all, you know, crazy, going up to those bears and stuff. So
yeah, I mean, I think that's all believable, but I mean, I think the whole him getting eaten thing with his girlfriend.
And then they had
the coroner. I never seen the girlfriend.
Well, she was eaten.
Well, yeah, but I don't remember ever seeing her in like any of the footage of him being out there with her.
Oh, I mean, it's been a while since I watched it, but I thought they had some footage of her in there somewhere.
I always thought it was like that, like Survivor Man or whatever, where he's like setting up his own cameras, and then, you know, he'd go out and like run out to the river or whatever where the bears were, and like, hey, Cynthia, hi, good morning.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, most of that footage, I think, because didn't he do that like for quite a few years before he met her? And then.
Maybe that's true, because he kept flying out there, that's right.
Yeah, I think like the way the story goes is then he met her and she decided to go, you know, do it with them. And that one decided to eat him. Which, I mean, they had like the coroner and stuff on there talking about, you know, getting the contents out of the bear's stomach after they shot it and stuff. And,
oh, really? I don't remember that.
And they had the pilot. The pilot was giving his like recount of coming in, and the bear was, you know, eating the one guy and all that.
I remember the pilot talking. That's right. I remember the pilot talking, and he was like, he could see the rib cage of someone.
Yeah.
That's a rough way to go.
Oh man, that would be rugged, dude. I would not want to get eight.
Especially by those were Kodiaks, right? Or what were they? They were grizzly bears, right?
They were definitely grizzlies, but they could have been Kodiak. I don't remember if they were on that island or not. Like the Kodiaks are all on that Kodiak island. But I mean, grizzly bears are super dangerous too.
Are Kodiaks as big as they made them in that movie? Because they made them like, I remember he just picked up that black dude in that movie and just whipped him around like nothing. And that scared the hell out of me when I was a little kid.
Well, you remember in like sort of in that Grizzly Bear Man show or whatever they call that movie, and they show that one. I always remember that one shot of him, the one bear scratching his back on that tree, and he's like standing up. And
yeah, then he's like huge, right?
Yeah, and then he goes away, and the guy walks up to that tree and stands in front of it, and that bear's like 4 feet tall, like over top of him. You know, like where is that bear's head would have been is like a good 4 feet above him. I mean, just massive. You know.
Jeez.
Just a giant. I mean,
I don't know what that guy was thinking, man.
That dude was
like nuts, honestly, man. What? Why do you, you know? I understand you like bears and everything, but you know, flying out there and like living with them and stuff. What do you? You know, the chances of you getting eaten are pretty great, I would say.
Yeah, I mean that's what ended up happening too. So. I don't know. That was an awesome show. I really like that. But I don't know. Like to me, if I was, you know, like now we're talking about getting ate by something, I'll throw out my opinion on what would be worse than getting ate by a grizzly bear. And I don't know why I feel this way, but I feel like getting ate by a shark would be worse than eaten by a grizzly bear. And I don't know why.
Really?
I think it's just because I'm more scared of sharks for some reason.
Couldn't you, like, if you knew you were going to get eaten, couldn't you, like, just drown yourself?
How horrible is that?
What's worse?
How would you know? I mean, you know, like, you wouldn't know you were going to get eaten by a shark until he's eating you, though.
Well, you wouldn't, like, see him coming?
Well, I mean, you can't drown yourself like that. It takes a minute for you to, like, run out of oxygen and stuff.
I guess I don't know.
You might see him coming. But, you know, you see in, like, those documentaries where they come, like, for the whatever they call those, the sea lions and stuff, and they come, like, blasting out of the water from, like, way down deep, you know?
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, that's probably not a good idea, because my luck, I would drown myself, and the thing wasn't even interested.
Yeah, he's just coming over to take a look. It's like a dolphin. Oh man.
You wouldn't want like a Bigfoot to take you out?
No. I mean, you know.
How cool would that be? Like to know
to take me out.
How cool would it be though to know like as you're getting eaten, you're like, you guys do exist.
He is real. Yeah.
This whole damn time.
Man. There was one time I actually remember having this discussion at work, and somebody, you know, I was like throwing out my opinion of like being eaten was a bad way to go. And this younger kid was all like, I don't know about that. You know, it's kind of like, then you sort of go into like the circle of life, you know, you're in the food chain. Just like, shut up, get back to work.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I don't know what would be a good way to, like, if the only way you could die was to get eaten by something. Well, I guess you would just pick nothing, right?
Get eaten by, like, army ants. That would have to be the worst. Piranhas. Well, do you ever see, like, the documentary on the army ants where they, like, the one I saw was, like, there was these chickens, and this chicken house, and the army ants come, and they basically like just all go start and shove themselves down the chicken's throat until the chicken like suffocates. Oh and then God. They all just start eating him. Yeah. It's like, oh my God. Talk about teamwork.
At least they kill him. I mean, they could just start eating him, right? At least they're, you know, kind enough to kill him first.
Well, maybe they figured like if they don't do that, he'll run off or something. Why are you laughing at that? Doesn't that make sense?
I guess so. I didn't even think like, you know, he's just not gonna stay there. Let me do.
I don't know. Hopefully, I'm not gonna be eaten.
Yeah, that'd be a rough way to.
Or actually, what I would hate to be eaten by is like by a human. That would be the worst.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, I'd rather be eaten by a grizzly bear than a human for sure. That sucks.
Well, I'm sure a human though would kill you fast, though, right?
Yeah, but I mean, like,
humans are just gonna shoot you, and then
it's like degrading, and then they make like a documentary about you, and you know they don't even like mention that you're like a great artist. You're just like the fucking victim of a serial killer. That sucks. I don't want that.
Well, they're not gonna. I doubt they'd mention it in the paper if you got eaten by a bear either.
They might.
They might. Yeah, they might. I guess.
The forest was covered with sketchbook pages. Oh, I guess that's true, but I don't know. I just don't want to. I don't want to get you know give somebody the satisfaction.
That makes me of mad. Eating you.
Yeah.
You want to provide nourishment to some weirdo?
That's right. That's right. I mean, it's so funny. Like, I mean, I don't even want the conversation to go there, but I saw this one documentary. I get on these crime shows sometimes. Like, some nights I'll stay up watching crime shows.
Yeah.
And, like, watch them on that one streaming site. So it's really bad because, like, once I start watching one, you know, they always have, like, 14 episodes, and I'm, like, watching, like, 14 episodes of true crime. And they had this one that was all about cannibalism. Oh, and, geez. Like, this dude. Yeah, maybe I shouldn't even bring it up because I don't want to give you.
No, I want to hear it now.
Well, anyway, it was like some German guy, and he's like, you know, the classic, you know, raised by his mother and, you know, all that kind of stuff. And he's like, you know, 40 something years old, and his mom dies, and all of a sudden, you know, it's party time. And so he gets on like some cannibal forum. Online.
Oh, so this is like recently, like where the internet's around.
Yeah.
I thought you were talking like an older thing for some reason.
Yeah. Yeah, this ain't the Alfred Packard, you know, 1800 story. Anyway. He gets online and then he finds this guy. I mean, they're talking about cannibalism. He's all into cannibalism, blah, blah, blah. And he finds this guy who basically wants to be eaten. He's like a dude with like a suicide wish that wants to be eaten. And so like he gets to be friends with this guy. The guy comes over and they what decide the to like do it. Yeah. And so like the guy has all this like anesthetic and stuff, like doctor, you know, anesthesia and all this kind of stuff. And the dude gets in a bathtub and then like he numbs him up and then starts cutting pieces off of him. And the guy's still alive. He goes downstairs, he cooks up part of him, and they both eat him while he's still living, and then he kills him after that. And then he's like looking for like a second victim or whatever. But this guy, he thought he was going to get away with it because this guy, like, he actually had him like sign a contract and everything that like it was okay for me to eat you. And this guy had like this suicide wish, so he signed it, I guess. I mean, sick, but that's what it was. And so anyway, while he's looking for like the second victim, then people start to like go, wow, this guy's really into cannibalism. And somebody gives a tip to the police, and they come over and check his freezer. So
pretty what happened? Up. Did he get off because he had the contract, or did they even recognize that?
No, they basically said that it was wrong. And he also filmed the whole thing, so.
Oh my God.
It's like, you know, even if you like you have a contract to murder somebody, you're still not supposed to be murdering somebody. So he went to jail. And they said that he was like, you know, a serial killer in the making, basically, but they caught up with him before he had a chance to eat a bunch of more people. That's fucked up, dude.
Oh yeah. Hell yeah. Did he get like life in prison or?
Oh, something like that. I don't really remember what they said, but so I don't it wasn't want like, you know.
I don't want him like, all right. I don't want him to be like, oh, yeah, we caught him just before he became a mass murderer, but the crime we caught him in wasn't that bad, so he's going to be out in 5 years.
Oh, my God. Yeah, so somebody's actually commenting. They must have saw the same. Werner Herzog is definitely a nut, too. Oh, maybe this is a different guy. He bought the audio recording of his death to that woman and filmed her reaction. Pretty exploded.
Oh, he's talking about, I think he's talking about the Grizzly Man, right?
Was Where it? No, like, it was his. Werner Herzog was a nut, too. He brought the audio recording of his death to that woman and filmed her reaction. Oh, okay. I know what you're talking about. So, yeah, he's actually talking about the documentary. And then, because she listened to it and then filmed it. Mm. So here's another guy that's agreeing that the filmmaker is like a weirdo. So maybe there was some weirdo thing that I just wasn't picking up on there, dude. Maybe you're right.
He seemed really creepy, man. I don't know.
Mm.
I didn't know his name though, but I don't know. I just.
Yeah. Yeah, he says Herzog was the director. So thanks, Ryan. Yeah, that's pretty nuts.
Who was that lady? The guy's mom. It was the mom, right? That he was like letting listen to the son's death, and he was like wanting to know if she wanted to release the footage. Like she didn't want to watch it, so they were just like listening to it. But they actually like filmed it, right? Or no, the guy had the cap on the. That's what it was. The guy was trying to film him getting eaten, but he couldn't get the cap off of the lens, right?
Well, no, because the guy got attacked first. I think he took the camera out to film, like it was going to be one of those like interactions with the bear kind of films. And then he started getting eaten and dropped the camera, and I think it just kept recording. So it was all on tape, you know what I mean?
So they did have like actual footage of him getting eaten?
I don't know if they had footage. I think that's why it was just audio. Is because, you know, the camera lands wherever, and then, you know, they can hear the guy screaming. And then, so this guy knows what's going on. He says she was just a friend. Pretty crazy. Hey, you know, this is kind of off topic, but I was going to ask. We may as well jump off the cannibal topic and go to something else. Huh?
Let's milk it a little bit more.
I got some more.
I got no more cannibal stories.
But I was wondering, have you ever seen that show called The Detour? It's like a comedy that's on right now. This show is like pretty hilarious, dude.
Is it, what is it, like a network show or something?
Yeah, it must be on some cable channel. I found it on this streaming site thing, but it's like, I actually watched the second season before I watched the first season, but the first season is like, they're just like a family and they go on vacation. And it's just like, I don't know. I mean, I'm sure I can't tell it as funny as it is, but it's just like really hilarious. Like, I don't really like laugh that much at comedies and stuff, but like this one, you know, like I was in here just like laughing my head off when I was watching it. Yeah. I mean, you know, like you were talking about liking that Shameless show and stuff. And this show is like, I think this is like way funnier than that one.
I didn't think that show was funny. I didn't think that was funny. The Shameless show?
Yeah.
I didn't think that show was like sad, man.
No humor at all. There's funny moments, though.
Well, I'm sure there's funny parts. I only made it to like maybe 4 or 5 episodes in.
Oh, really?
And yeah, my sister she watched the entire thing, like all the seasons she could watch.
Yeah.
I only made it to like 4 or 5 episodes. That mom was like trying to get out of the house and she couldn't. I remember. She had like some sort of disease. Yeah, I don't know. I left off right when the neighbors who own that bar or whatever.
Yeah.
They were just getting married, and he was already married to someone else, and he didn't want to tell her yet or something.
Oh, okay.
That's where I left off. And I don't know what happens. I know that like one of the moms was trying to get out, but she had like some sort of disease and she couldn't. And then that guy left and he was like secretly a clown fan or something. I don't know.
It's been a while since I watched the beginning of it. So it's like hard for me. I remember parts of like what you're talking about, but I don't remember the clown fan thing. But
he had like a trunk full of clown, like memorabilia.
Yeah.
And when he left her, he like was taking it all. Like, and he was also a mailman or something.
Oh, like the one dad of like the little, like the real slutty girlfriend of Lips, yeah, or whatever.
Yeah. Okay, the Lips dad, he moved in with that girl.
Yeah. He hooks up with his mom's girlfriend or whatever. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, the girl who never wanted to leave.
Yeah.
Or she wanted to, but she couldn't. She had some sort of disease where she didn't leave the house.
Oh, like her mom had that. Yeah. 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 Like, and later in the show, I forgot all about that. Yeah. Later in the show, she gets over that. So she doesn't have anymore. But yeah, her mom had the whatever disease that is where you got to stay in the house all the time.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, I don't know. I think that girl's really pretty. The main girl on that show.
The sister, the older sister or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought she was really pretty, but you know, I never kept going with the show.
Oh, that's weird. I thought you were all like way into that show. So maybe you wouldn't dig this other one then.
I mean, it's interesting. It's not like I didn't find it like funny or, you know, there's some funny parts, I guess, but I just remember feeling like sad for that like family, I guess. I could relate to some of the situations and stuff, I guess.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, and I think just because I went to New York, I kind of just fell off.
Oh,
but
yeah.
I might pick it up again.
Yeah, I think there's like a new season out too that I haven't seen yet. So I got to jump back on and watch some more. That show.
What it was I jumped off of it because you got me into Spartacus.
Oh,
you, yeah, and my sister, you guys got me into that, and so I jumped into that.
Spartacus is awesome.
And then once I started that, I didn't really care about anything else.
Yeah. I'm kind of like rewatching that a little bit. Not like through the whole thing, but like every now and then I'll like when I can't find nothing else to watch, I'll pop one of those in. So good, man.
There's a story or a documentary that's on Netflix that I haven't seen yet. But I really want to. It's the Andy Whitfield story, like how that dude who originally was him died and like what happened and everything.
Oh, wow.
My sister watched it. She said she was crying the whole time.
Hmm. Yeah, it amazes me like he died of cancer. I mean, the guy's like totally in shape and everything like that. It just, I guess it doesn't matter.
Oh, it was definitely cancer that got him. I thought it was like some sort of some other disease that just,
I don't know. You might be right. I mean, I always thought it was cancer, but I don't know that I really had the whole story.
Yeah, I don't know. The guy that took over for him, he did a pretty good job, man.
Yeah, once I got used to him, like when I first saw it, like the new guy, I was like, oh, this isn't Spartacus. But then I don't know, a couple episodes in, I was like on board.
So. Yeah. And that year they changed a couple of them. They changed like the girl that Crixus was going after.
Yeah, that girl gets changed at some point.
And I didn't like the new girl.
It's hard to like think that she's the same girl because I was like watching the end. Like, yeah, right at the, you know, the end when they're all getting killed and stuff. And I was like, I could, you know, it's hard to like even think like, oh yeah, she was actually that one chick from, you know, the beginning, you know, because she just seems so different. It's a good damn good show. I wish they'd do something more like that. They should make Conan, but like make it like Spartacus. That'd be fucking awesome.
Yeah, that would be pretty cool.
Yeah.
Are they still doing whatever happened to that Conan with Schwarzenegger? Is that still happening? Where he's like the old mm-hmm. king or whatever?
I haven't heard anything. I remember when they were saying they were going to do that, but maybe they're making it. Who knows?
Or was that the one with? Because didn't they release a Conan with some other dude and it sucked?
They did the one with the guy who's going to be Aquaman, and I didn't really dig the movie. I did like him as Conan though. You know, he's
that's the guy that's Conan in that.
Yeah, he makes a really good Conan, I think. But I think just as a movie, I don't know if that movie's that entertaining. But yeah, that came out a little while ago. But that didn't have any Schwarzenegger or anything in it, though.
All right. Because I thought that they were going to make him like the Keen.
That's what they're saying. It's going to be like a kind of a sequel to like the first two with Schwarzenegger.
Yeah.
And he's supposed to be like older, you know? Which would be kind of cool. I wouldn't mind seeing that. But I don't know. I don't know if it'll be good or not. It's hard to say. I mean, the guy who played Conan also was like, he's like that barbarian kind of character in Game of Thrones, which is like pretty much Conan in a way, you know?
I've never seen anything of that.
Yeah.
I know it's like super popular though.
Yeah. I keep trying to get into it, and I don't know what it is. I just can't stick with it. I watch it for a little while, and then I just will go off of it. It just doesn't seem to really resonate with me. I've been watching, this is another one I got to get back and watch the new season, though. It's like the Vikings. Have you seen any of those?
No.
They're really good, dude. I bet you'd actually dig it.
Huh. Is it? That's not the Black Sails one, right? That's a different one.
No, I tried watching some of that one, and I don't know. It's kind of, I guess it's sort of along the same lines, but to me, like, the Vikings is, like, just so much better.
The other ones, like, pirates, right?
Yeah, the Black Sails is pirates, and the Vikings is just about Vikings, basically. But it's all dramatized, you know?
I'll have to see if I can get into, if I can find that one. I'm sure, I hope it's on Netflix or Hulu.
Yeah, I'm sure it is. Yeah, to me, like, I don't know. I mean, nobody really says anything, but I was trying to watch Game of Thrones, and then, like, I like the Vikings, you know, to me, like, that's fucking way better than Game of Thrones, but I don't know. I guess people don't feel the same. Game of Thrones just seems, I don't know, just there's something about it just seems like everybody's a bastard in that one, and maybe I just can't root for anybody or something, but it just, I don't know, I just don't get into it. I'm just like, everybody's an asshole on this show.
You know? Even the, like, Dragon Queen or whatever she is?
Well, I guess she's not, but everybody fucking else is, so.
I know this one dude is, like, really want from, like, my old job. He's, like, trying to get me to... He's like, there's this one huge guy, and he like squeezes the eyeballs out of this little guy, and I was like, oh, what time does that come on?
Yeah, I've had like so many people, especially when they find out I like Lord of the Rings and that kind of stuff, and they're just like, ah, oh, you gotta watch Game of Thrones. Stick with it, you're gonna love it. And I really have tried. I don't know. I just don't stick with them. I just don't. Eventually, I'm just like, eh.
Have you ever seen that? I think it's called Hell on Wheels. My folks are telling me that's really good. It's like a Western show.
I've seen it on there, and I've been meaning to try it. Because like I always thought it was like a biker show, but I guess it's a Western, so that's kind of interested me. So... But I haven't tried it yet, though.
Yeah, if it's like a cowboy thing, I definitely want to check it out.
Yeah.
You don't really see very many cowboy TV shows, like, ever, really.
Well, there was one I was watching. What was that one called? It had, like, Wild Bill Hickok in it. It's like in South Dakota. What's it called?
Wild Deadwood? Bill Hickok.
Yeah, Deadwood. That's what the show is called.
Oh, and, I've never even heard of it.
Yeah, it's not too bad. I mean, it's along the lines of all these kind of cable shows. So there's like quite a few seasons. And that one was pretty decent. I mean, I definitely watched all the way through that one. My dad was really into it, but I wasn't quite as much as him, but I liked it, though.
There's one out now that my buddy was telling me about, and it actually sounds really good. I guess it's based off of a Stephen King novel or short story or something. But it's like these people who they like rent bodies or something. I'm trying to remember like how he was explaining it, but they like rent. They like rent something, and they like go to this other world, and like at that world, it's all Western.
Oh wow!
And it's crap. I'm not doing a good job explaining it. I know what the show is called, Westworld, I think, or Westwood or Westworld.
Yeah, I mean, there's, you know what? No, that's probably it, because they've remade. There was a movie called Westworld when I was a kid, which was awesome. And it's like a Western amusement park that you go to. Right. And then the robots go crazy and start killing everybody. And then, like, I've seen, you know, on the that one thing I look watch movies, there's like a Westworld. They made a TV show out of it. I didn't realize that was Stephen King, though, that wrote that.
It might not be, but I thought – I could have sworn my buddy said it was. So
Well, that's cool. I'll have to check that out.
He was telling me how cool it was, and it sounded really intriguing to me, but I couldn't find it anywhere. I'm like, I guess it just came out, and it's on Showtime or something.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think it's pretty new. I'll have to check it out, though.
It seems really interesting. I definitely want to check it out.
Yeah. Abe Sapien says Dark Tower, which that's like a Stephen King book. Did they ever make like a TV show of that, though? I wouldn't mind watching that, because I read a little bit of like one of the books and it looked pretty good, but I just don't read much, so I'd like to watch the movie version of it.
Dark Tower, that sounds pretty cool.
Yeah.
So I didn't know that there was robots in that. So there's robots in the amusement park, and they come to life and kill everyone?
Well, like, I don't know what the new one is, but in the movie, you know, back in the day, it was like, you know, you get to go to like the old west and pretend to be a cowboy, and so, you know, you gunsling, you know, you get into a fight with a robot cowboy and shoot him down. It's like no big deal, you know what I mean? They just take it out, repair it, put him back on the street kind of thing, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then at some point the robots wake up and they, you know, will try to like take over. And so, you know, when you're shooting them, it doesn't kill them, and they're trying to kill the people in Westworld, and that's kind of the premise of it.
So are they in their real bodies, or are they
in the old movie? Yeah, they were you're just in your own body. You just kind of like suit up in a little cowboy suit or something. But like, that sounds kind of neat if you can actually, you know, like in this one, you like get into some other body or something. That sounds pretty wild.
I don't think it's been around for very long. I think it just started.
Yeah. Well, it's actually 1:30. I wonder if we should jump off, because I think we probably even went over like 2 hours tonight.
Oh, really? All right. Yeah.
But thanks for watching, everybody. I don't know if we'll be back tomorrow or not, but yeah, it was fun. What do you think, Mike?
Thanks, everyone.
Okay. See you guys.